First World Order Radio, finally, we are on the air, no doubt. All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Proceeding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Proceeding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories. Shit that works.
Peace. Once again, you back with Dr. Aleem El Bey's show. Tonight, we're going to get into mental revolution and physical solutions. Now, what we're going to do is start off with some current events, things in which that aren't in the news right now. And I have to bust it out like this because there's a lot of things going on in which that we're not being told. That's definitely not in the mainstream media. So, what we're going to do is go over some information. For example, there's an article in which that states why no proper investigation of the 25 mysterious deaths. And these mysterious deaths are actually deaths of scientists, of people who actually worked at GEC, Marconi's, and Plassey. And if anyone know who or what Marconi Incorporated is and Plassey Incorporated, you know that they deal with electronics. Now, we come to find out that through the investigation that they have ties to the Star Wars defense program of the 1980s, in which that Ronald Reagan was sprouting off. Now, that correlates to the HARP system in which that they have, as well as also to the chemtrails. So we have that over 25 Marconi scientists mysteriously died, you know. As a matter of fact, there's a list in which that is actually compiled by Raymond A. Robinson. And he goes off basically into the 1980s, and he says in the 1980s, over 24 science graduates and experts working for Marconi and Plassey defense systems died in mysterious circumstances. Most appeared to be suicides. Now, you're wondering, how come we going to the 1980s? Because that was during the time when crack hit the scene and AIDS hit the scene. Matter of fact, they hit almost simultaneously, 1983, 1984. And basically, it wrecked shop. All right? So we're going to see the correlations between what took place in the 80s as far as their drug war. All right? And we know actually it was the war on drugs, as they refer to it as. And basically what that was all about was actually putting drugs into the neighborhoods, and particularly into the black, so-called black or said black neighborhoods. We know that for a fact. There's been too many reports in which that has stated it, that the CIA was actually putting drugs into the black community. All right? And I'm just using the word black in order, because that's the word in which that we have become so accustomed to. But we are Moors. So, you know, y'all have to have that overstanding, understanding, and understanding also. And Moor is a noun. Black is an adjective. So, but I will use it based on the fact that this is what we have become accustomed to, so you can understand what's really taking place and that you won't be offended. You know, because there are some who are offended and they're so, you know, pro-black that when they read certain words being defined by Black's Law Dictionary or any other dictionary, it goes beyond their comprehension, it seems, to the difference between an adjective and a noun. But we're not going to get into that. Let's get back to these scientists, all right? And matter of fact, he puts the list together, and he actually goes over these scientists, in which that was working on some particular inventions, you know. And, for example, like March 1982, Professor Keith Bowen, who was 46, his expertise was computer programming scientist at Essex University, engaged in the work for Marconi, who was held as an expert on the supercomputers and computer-controlled aircraft. The circumstances of death is fatal car crash when his vehicle went out of control across a dual carriageway and plunged into a disused railway line. Police maintained he had been drinking, but his family and friends all denied the allegation. So the coroner verdict was that is an accident. April 1983, Lieutenant Colonel Anthony Godley, 49, head of work study unit at the Royal College of Military Science. Circumstances of death: disappeared mysteriously without explanation, but soon to be dead. March 1985, Roger Hill, 49, expertise, radar designer. All right, and draftman with Marconi. On circumstances of death, died by a shotgun blast at home, ruled a suicide. November 19th, 1985, Jonathan Wash. His expertise was digital communication. Expert working at the GEC and at the British Telecom Secret Research Center in Suffolk, and the circumstances of his death was allegedly the result of falling from a hotel room in West Africa, in Abidjan, West Africa. Now, that's just some of the names. I'll go over the rest of them in a minute here. But this is going to be this is really going to be research study tonight, all right? This isn't going to be just the average just talking off the top of the dome. We're going to put these things together, all right? Now, this is what this article says. There's been at least 25 mysterious deaths of people who worked for GEC, Marconi, the defense arm of GEC, on the Stingray torpedo project between 1982 and 1988. The death of the British defense journalist Jonathan Morley was, who was found hanged in his Santiago hotel room in April 1st, 1990, and he has also been subject of speculation as being connected to the Marconi death. Now, this is what it says: four of the men were employed at the CG Group, three at Marconi's and one at Ezam Ltd. Two others is working at separate times at the Royal Military College of Science. An investigation of computer news established that most of the men was involved in the computer simulation and key part of the defense procurement. It goes on that at the time, GEC Marconi was British only torpedo supplier, and in 1986 was awarded $400 million for the military Ministry of Defense for advancement of anti-submarine Stingray torpedoes. Now, you got to understand is that they're saying all of this is torpedoes. However, we know that the same information can be utilized in other fields. The same technology can be used in other fields. So we come to find out that it says that GEC Marconi was or are involved with all of the major defense companies, and that's Marconi's Electronic System, MES, and GEC Marconi's, as it were, up until 1998. It was the defense arm for the General Electric Company, and it was connected also to the British Aerospace, all right, which is called the BEA, or the BAE Systems. All right, so when we read more of the article, it goes into the fact that Plassey and Marconi was involved in classified Star Wars projects. All right, now Star Wars projects, like we said, Star Wars defense program was what Ronald Reagan in 1984 started sprouting off on, you know, actually on TV, as a matter of fact, in which that he stated that if there was ever an attack from outer space, him and Gorbachev would have to come together in order to put down their differences, lay down their differences, and unify, and this program would be that. Now, amazingly, that these same scientists' death was during the same time as they was waging war, the drug war, all right? Now it's the war on terror, all right? So you got to understand what is going on here. Every time they have a ploy such as the war on drugs, there's something else underlying in which that they're doing much more massively. And what they're doing more massively is during the 80s, was cracking AIDS. Nowadays is chemtrails and ARP, genetically altered food called Frankenfoods. All right, we're going to show the connections in a second here. But you have in October 1986, Arshad Sharif, his expertise was on working on systems to detect submarines by satellites. January 1987, Richard Park, he was a computer consultant and digital computer communication expert. You had January 12, 1987, Dr. John Britton, who was actually a scientist, you know, from the Royal College of Military Science, and he was working on top secret work, right? And his death is supposed to have been carbon monoxide poisoning in his own garage. All right, February 1987, you have David Shields. His expertise was engineering at Marconi's. February 1987, Victor Moore. Expertise, design, engineer with Marconi Space and Defense System. All right, February 22nd, 1987, Peter Pippel, 46, scientist at the Royal College of Military Science. Now, you got to understand, the military keeps showing up here, satellite, defense, space, communication, digital, computers, all of these things keep showing up and over again as far as keywords, as far as these scientists are concerned. And like we said, when we read the report, it's talking about Star Wars, which, of course, anyone who go and do their research on HARP is part of that Star Wars defense program. But in order to make HARP activated and work properly, the chemtrails has to be utilized, and which that helps with the weather modification. Now, not only helps with weather modification, you know, it also deals with mind control, as well as also it deals with certain spores or bacteria in which that is also dropped from the chemtrails. The military claims that is a way for mass vaccination. All right. Now, of course, we beg to differ. All right. We know what they're dropping actually becomes what's called Morgellon. Morgellon is a disease with multi levels of illnesses, ranging from cancer to herpes to et cetera. All these symptoms are what you will have. And what is occurring because it is altering the DNA. And this is purposely done. Okay? This is purposely done. Now, let me see here. We have, I guess there's a question. I'll go to the question right quick. Might be something in which they can be added on. Area code 314. Area code 314, you're on the line.
Islam, more Brother Resident Hill, St. Louis, Missouri, Republic.
Yes, greetings, brother.
Yes, sir. How you doing, brother? Right. Yes, sir. I have a book on the HARP Project, and I have been studying on mind control since 92, dealing with religions, which are have been reduced to a mind control institutions. HARP. I don't know how I used to watch a program, but Jesse Ventura. I don't know how valid his show is. I have questions about that.
Right, but it's valid enough that we can definitely see that something is going on.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Because he was trying to get into one of the HARP stations. I believe it was Arizona.
And I know there was another one in Kanoka, Alaska, also.
He was trying to get in there, and him being as an ex-Navy SEAL, seemed like he should have had access to it, but they wouldn't allow him in there.
Right.
You know, so this must be very deep than what they, you know, very deep than most people know. As far as the war on drugs, as far as my concern, there's never been a real war on drugs or a real war on terror. A lot of that is just another legal fiction that they're trying to put over the public and the people to have their belief and faith that it's real, but it's not real. Myself, I believe that the government, mainly the banking, corporate banking institution, the industrialists, without them, the drug trade cannot survive.
Exactly, because the CIA themselves have thousands of companies in which that they have under them in which that distribute these particular drugs to the street itself. You know, I mean, so if there's any, I mean, this has been verified even through Congress. This has been demonstrated. A matter of fact, with the CIA being established in the 1950s, by the 1970s, it was actually put before Congress about the CIA actually utilizing LSD. On the citizens and the population of the Americans, citizens. You know.
Yeah.
So we know that they don't have a problem doing these particular things. You know, so this is just a continuation. This is what we're showing is a continuation of these betrayals and treasons that is taking place against we the people.
Yeah.
You know.
Yes, I also picked up on what you were talking about the AIDS epidemic and the something else you talked about, AIDS and the
crack.
The crack, yes, sir. at the same year simultaneously. Right. I believe that was part of the what they call the future shock waves. The shock the public and then the people.
Right.
So they won't be able to really be so stymied that they won't be able to really recover from it.
Right.
Counter it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, everything is like everybody is chasing after something, and really it's all an illusion. It does not exist. You take like what they call the almighty dollar. It's all an illusion because they work, you know, work themselves to death over something that does not exist. And this is part of the mind control system, I believe, along with, as I say, religion, whether it be the Christian, it might be the church, even the mosque, to my utter surprise. Because when I'm in my early years, I was a Muslim with the Nation of Islam. And there's certain things they will always try to advise certain Muslims not to read. And definitely when they deal with certain types of dealing with moral science, or when they're dealing with certain books dealing with conspiracy issues about the Federal Reserve, how the Federal Reserve works, and about the phony drug war on drugs.
Right. Now, amazingly, Minister Farrakhan is talking on all these same issues now.
Yeah, he talks on them. He talks on them.
Mm-hmm.
Every time they see you with a book, there's certain members that, lower members, like the certain, what you call lieutenants or whatever.
But I know what they used to tell me was that, but brother, that's branch knowledge. You need root knowledge.
Right. Right. Because I was reading things about books like...
I used to tell my brother, I need tree knowledge.
Right, tree knowledge. You know, like numerology. I'll put it that way. Numerology, occult numerology. The law of brother will say, brother, you need to be careful with that.
Right.
You need to read that so much. And I'm like, why? You know, the occult numerology is dealing with real numerology. Because I listened to one European, he was saying he lives in the occult world. And he explained to him why he lives in the occult world, because he's explaining to him that the occult world is the real world we're living in.
Right, and the occult is nothing more than hit means hidden. But what he's talking about is that he utilized the energies in which that he's a concentration of. You know, he utilized those same energies through the projection of his mind. And we all have to learn how to do this. You know, that's actually part of this tonight's program, because that's actually what they are afraid of. Is us learning how to use those capabilities.
Yeah, the occult science of the monetary system, the occult science of even mental issues, dealing with emotions. This is the occult science to all to those, you know, that people don't like to tap into. I had made a statement at the temple I go to, and I wanted to explain something about dealing with, I believe it was dealing with money, and I cut the conversation short because the brother asked me, "How come you didn't? Why you stopped all of a sudden?" I said, "Well, they don't like certain things to be discussed in the temple." You know, they don't like certain things I say. They don't care to me to say them. You know, when I'm dealing with, like you say, the artificial person.
Right.
And I was stopped in the middle of my statement. she came and tell me, so I said, well, he written on the board talking about nationality. And I said, well, also it deals with the artificial person and the natural living person. And right there, he stopped me. Which I thought was interesting, you know, but he never explained to me why. You know?
That is interesting, because I would like for him to explain to you why. Because I mean, if he want and you know want you to continue coming, and he endear his membership, then he should be able to answer those particular questions. Because If not, then that's probably the same mind control tactics in which that is being utilized, you know, throughout the world, which is part of the divide and conquer tactic, in which that if there's no proper explanation, you know, then there's a problem in which that is going to occur. People are going to go outside of temples and start seeking truth or information or facts, and that's what is going to happen. So you have to be able to answer those questions inside your arena. Otherwise, people will leave your arena, you know.
Right.
And but that's what's going to happen if he don't continue answering those particular questions, Brother Redland. So I will push him. You know, I mean, I know we was taught in Christianity not to question the pastor or the preacher or the minister. However, I wasn't taught that in Islam, not to question the emir or the imam. Or I wasn't taught not to question the grand sheikh or grand sheikhess.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I mean, if you want to damn do the Christian number on me and act like I'm not supposed to question you, then, I mean, what good are you?
Right, right. And sometimes I usually be kind of cautious, but now, but last Sunday I wasn't.
Right,
like
right.
I defended, defined and interpreted what the feds meant.
Mm-hmm.
And it seemed like everybody liked it. And the next thing I know, I was approached by the grand governor. He said he wanted me to come there Friday to make a speech. One of these Fridays, he wanted to give me a call. So I was kind of surprised.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess they want to know more. To see more of what I know.
Of course, because these are adept chamber lessons, brother, and you as just a member, you're not supposed to know this.
See, I didn't know that.
Right. So that's the whole point of shocking the hell out of them, is to let them know that you do know, so that, you know, they can go on and do what they need to do as far as putting people through the adept chamber, so that they can come out and teach this thing properly, because I'm not seeing it being taught properly. I'm seeing everybody trying to segue themselves into their own cult as a division and then claim to be right, you know, just like no different than a Baptist or Methodist or Pentecostal Holiness or Jehovah's Witness or Seventh-day Adventist. It's no different. It's just becoming a group of sex cult schisms and isms.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
I know exactly what you're saying. Yes, sir. Another thing I found out, that the drug trade is so deep. The drug trade is so deep. A lot of people will be shocked. But still, they don't even believe if I tell them that their own so-called government, which is a corporation, is involved.
Oh, yeah, no doubt about it. I mean, that's how they've been financing. They had what's called the Triangle Golden Crest, in which that was between China, Afghanistan, in Great Britain, basically, in which that was funneling heroin, you know, or what is basically called, you know, the poppy plant.
Okay.
You know, matter of fact, that was one of the reasons why when George Bush was in office, he told them farmers in Afghanistan to get back to growing the poppy plant. That was part of the whole plan.
Okay.
No, to get that heroin, that was going to be the new joint. That was going to be the drug, you know, that heroin. You know, heroin is part of the mixing in ecstasy also. It was going to be able to utilize that heroin pretty well. You
see,
know
that I didn't know.
Yeah, they're going to use that pretty well.
And, because I know I've heard that the United States Corporation is in debt to China.
Right.
I believe it was, what, $8 billion? What, I can't remember.
Yeah, it's supposed to be $7 billion.
$7 billion.
And, of course, I'm pretty sure with the interest, it would be going up to $8 billion, but that was due to the bailout, the stimulus program or plan in which that Obama came in, and that's where he borrowed the money from. He borrowed the money from the Chinese.
And when I forgot, and I was thinking to myself, I said, that's right, China backs their monetary system by gold.
Right. Now, this is what we're going to be talking about tonight, too, is that Utah and 11 other states, Utah the first, has already considered and actually have accepted is people to be able to utilize silver and gold.
You said Utah?
Yeah, Utah.
Oh, okay.
And 11 other states is going to soon follow behind them.
Oh, so the game is almost over.
Yeah, right, exactly.
So I know Oregon had their own currency.
Yeah.
On the news. They cut it off, though.
Right.
They cut them off. They didn't let them stay on too long. They
right.
just cut them off without no warning at all, you know. And they said that they were showing the people how they were doing this.
Right.
And because what I heard, they were, Oregon, the state of Oregon, was doing this for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
And they were, and then all of a sudden, boop, and they went to something else. And said, oh, that's the media. Okay, they don't want that to get out. They didn't want that to get out. Whoever who let that out, they're probably in trouble. Well, he probably fired by trying to find another job before this night is over with. Because you know how they control the media, how to tell the people to certain things and not to tell them certain things.
Right.
So, because I believe Oregon is close to being a republic again, isn't it?
They all are working towards that goal. You know, at least 11 to 12 of the said states. I know that actually about 15 states, all right, I think the highest number got up to around 21 states about 6 years ago, six, 7 years ago, they pulled out of the union, all right, of the so-called corporation. They pulled out. So I'm speculating that these exact same, you know, states in which that pulled out are the ones which are now going towards the silver and gold standard.
Okay, so that's, I'm going to say the game is almost up. Also, dealing with the AIDS epidemic, for some reason I haven't been hearing too much about AIDS lately.
Yeah, well, we know how AIDS was produced. Robert Gallo was one of the doctors in which that worked on. He was one of the main ones in which that basically AIDS was a fusion between a sheep Vishnu virus and a cattle virus. All right, and those two was combined, and it was put within a base of hepatitis B. For the ones here in the United States, and smallpox for the ones in Africa. And this
okay.
is how it spread it out.
Hmm.
Now, AIDS, of course, now there's a book called AIDS, America's United States Germ Warfare at its Best. It was written by Dr. Jack Felder, who's a chemist. Matter of fact, he's still living. He's in New York. Matter of fact, he's in Harlem. I've met with him several times. Sometimes he'd be right next to Brother Sarnetta on 125th Street.
Mm-hmm.
He's and he wrote that book back in the early 90s. And I actually did a report, you know, on that, you know. And that was a very impressive book. Very impressive, you know. So those who can get their hands on it, it's called AIDS, the United States Germ Warfare at its Best. And
okay.
it's written by Jack Felder, E-L-D-R.
Okay.
And you definitely want that in your arsenal.
Okay, I'll try to get hold of that.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Did he have a lot of threats on his life? Or?
All I know is that I never seen an updated or revised version of the book. Matter of fact, I don't even know if he still put the book out because I haven't even seen it. Because normally he sells DVDs and books and stuff on his table. I haven't even seen the book on his table. But people who go by Brother Sarnetta's table, you know, there in 125th Street, they can ask Brother Sarnetta, because sometimes Brother Jack Felder's son be out there, and they be dropping knowledge and everything. So, you know, it was right across the street from the Apollo, so you can't miss him.
Okay.
You know, that's for all sincere, you know, brothers and sisters who really want information. You know, I would say go in and find out what's going on, because that book is definitely important.
Okay. Okay, will do. Yeah, the speaking on the contrails. I know. I look at them every day, and I see the streaks in the skies and the planes. You know, it's like a lot of people think that's normal, and I try to tell them it's not.
Right.
That's not normal.
Right.
And because I was looking at a special we had with a special here in St. Louis called Out There TV, but it didn't last long because of the topics they were talking about.
Mm.
It didn't last long. It was called Out There TV.
Mm, Out There TV, okay.
That's what it was called. I even taped a couple of episodes.
Right.
And it was dealing with contrails. And they had these planes where they'd be flying in the air. They're just putting out these contrails, just putting them out there.
You're talking about the chemtrails?
Chemtrails, that's right. I'm sorry, excuse me. Chemtrails. And mm-hmm. A long time ago, I used to think they were normal. I thought they were just trails from the engines of the planes. You know?
Right, those are contrails. Those are the contrails,
okay.
Which is just exhaustion from the engines of the airplanes or aircrafts. But they dissipate. They disappear. However, chemtrails do not disappear.
Yeah, they stay there for a long time.
And matter of fact, they begin to spread out and actually create what is called a chem dome after a while, in which that the whole sky becomes gray and have an overcast.
That's what causes that. Okay.
Yeah. Now I've been to Canada. I've seen chemtrails there. I've been to Mexico, seen chemtrails there. All throughout the United States, chemtrails. I've been to London in England, seen chemtrails there. I have brothers who went to Germany, seen chemtrails there. So chemtrails is all over the world, basically. One of the few places in which they probably don't have chemtrails is China.
Okay.
Now, right?
It's kind of, I guess China not having it.
Right. It hasn't been reported, you know,
okay.
But everywhere else, basically, has been reported, you know, that these chemtrails have been all over the place. And the crazy thing is that within these chemtrails is not just aluminum, which is a reflective agent, as we spoke about before, or barium, but also these bacteria type of spores. And what happened is that these bacteria type of spores are actually getting onto the people's skin and inside their respiratory system, in which that is causing symptoms such as asthma and bronchitis, you know, these symptoms are at all times high right now. I mean, people are going to the hospital with respiratory sicknesses and like crazy.
At alarming rates.
Right, at alarming rates. And you're seeing people walk around with oxygen tanks.
I see that.
Right,
sure,
you've never
that.
Seen that before.
So I used to look at them as maybe got some kind of heart condition or something. You know?
Right. Years ago, you know, you didn't see that. Here it is 10 years later, you're seeing that. Well, we know that the chemtrails, I know the first time that we started building on the chemtrails was actually around the Olympic time in Atlanta, Georgia in 1996. All right. We found about the chemtrails in 1995. It was a book called Angels Don't Play This Harp, and it's by Dr. Nick Baggage. And in his book, he speaks about the government and their formation of these chemtrails and their connection possibly to the harp system. You know, so that's around the same time that we found out about harp and the same time we found out about these chemtrails.
You said earlier about harp, the chemtrails have to do something in order to harp to
right.
work with it.
Right. The chemtrails are utilized as a form of weather modification, and the harp is used in order to manipulate the weather conditioning. So it utilizes the chemtrails to do so. But
yeah.
In the process of utilizing the chemtrails for weather modification, what is happening, and the reason why they're using it is because these solar flare activities that are happening right now is the most powerful type of solar flares in which that within the last 100 years or so. Matter of fact,
okay.
The last had solar flare activity this strong. Matter of fact, there hasn't really been any recorded in which has been exactly this strong, but near this strong was in the mid to late 1800s, in which Daddy knocked down the power lines, knocked off the power lines, and at that time.
Hmm.
Of course, that was during the pre-industrious age. Now we're in the computer age now, so imagine what it would do now if they didn't do what they are doing. So it was a way in order to protect them from these extraterrestrials or these extraterrestrial energies in which that is coming into the planet. Now, these same extraterrestrials or extraterrestrial energies that is coming in is supposed to mutate us, and we're supposed to receive certain gifts in which that we once just had a glimpse of. Now we're going to have more than just a glimpse. We're going to have this on an everyday basis. In other words, the gifts of telepathy, telekinesis, psychometry, clairaudience, clairvoyance, clairsentience, clairgustance, you know, we're going to have all of these particular gifts.
But that's what they're trying to prevent.
Right, because what the solar flares are bringing in is ultraviolet light. Mm. If you get the book, The Ankh, written by Heru Samaj, the husband of Queen Afua, and well is also Brother Nur Ankh Amin.
Okay.
He writes in there that in the third dimension, melanin has a gap in between it. However, when it comes in contact with the fourth dimensional energies, such as ultraviolet light, melanin is filled. In other words, that gap is no longer there. So what they're trying to do is prevent that gap from being filled and from our DNA mutating to these particular gifts, in which that is, if you read 1 Corinthians, the 12th chapter, which this is for you Christians out there, if you can understand your scriptures. It speaks about the Holy Spirit and the different administrations of the Holy Spirit, in which that she would give you. The Holy Spirit is nothing more than the Kundalini. And she would give you the gift of prophecy, the gift of healing, the gift of miracles, the gift of speaking in tongues, interpreting tongues, the gift of discernment.
So there's a science to that.
Right,
so
there's a science.
The Holy Ghost and
the
speaking in tongues and
now,
things
see,
like that.
Right, when you see Christians in church short-circuiting and they dropping on the floor and they, you know, jumping all around and stuff, they short-circuiting. They can't handle the energy in which that is coming through them.
Okay.
So that's why they foaming at the mouth and all that shit.
Okay.
You know, so that's what is going on. So, yeah, they can speak in tongue, but there's oftentimes no interpreter there in order to know what is being said. Because they themselves are just simply babbling. They're not speaking another language in which that's what in the book of Acts is actually referring to.
Okay.
You know, okay. So, I mean, there's a lot of misconceptions going on. And like you said, religion is used as a mind control tool in order to accomplish that and to cause that division, you know, so that, you know, those who really want to know, they'll be stuck within those particular fields of religion for decades and eons.
Okay.
You know, it shouldn't take my great-grandmother to live to be almost 102 years old to still believe that white Jesus is coming.
Okay. Right. There you go. You know,
and that should have even been the case.
Well, I see a lot of Moors talk some almost the same language. You know, they're talking about the reincarnation of Jesus. Prophet Noble Dwali could have been the reincarnation of Jesus. And they're looking for a brother one day or a sister one day to be the reincarnation of Noble Dwali.
You're right.
You know, and they talking about when Jesus did this, when Jesus did that, like this, like he really existed.
Right,
you know?
But are they? But see, there's nothing wrong with understanding the concept of Christ being within man, because our law is
right.
In man.
Right.
The problem I have is when you give it an image, and the image in which that has been given to us is the people in which that dominates us and control and rule over us, you know, oppress and suppress and depress us. You know, I have a problem with that, you know, because that, to me, is the image of the beast mentioned in the book of Revelation, the 13th chapter. You know, that's the image of the beast. You know, it's living by an image other than your own. You're living by a concept other than your own. You're living by somebody else's visualization and imagination other than your own.
So therefore, you come from a slave to someone else's concept.
Hence, mind control.
Mind control. Back to mind control.
Right. Yes, that's the perfect mind control tool. You got 2 billion people on the planet believing in a white image. So hence, when they see that white image and we look at you, the white man or white woman, then we believe that you are superior to us because now you've made God in your image and after your likeness, instead of God being, instead of us being made after God in God's image.
Okay. Yeah. I was also dealing with a lot of other bacterial germs like the mad cow disease.
Right.
And
mad cow disease right now in the meat in which that is being used in these restaurants today. This mad cow disease, it has flooded the industry of the United States. Cattle industry. It is in the meats right now. People are eating mad cow and wondering why coming down with colon cancer and all of these types of things.
And going to restaurants like Ponderosa and the Outback and all that mess.
Yeah, yeah.
And think they're eating clean meat.
Right.
Because I was reading, I think it was a book that Minister Farrakhan had wrote. I think it was dealing with I forgot the name of the title, but it had it stated that the first recorded heart attack was in 1894.
Mm.
That was the first year they started what they call that the one with the meat. What was the word for that? Well, the first thing they start processing meat.
Okay.
The first year. And the first year was a recorded heart attack. I said, sure, there were heart attacks way before that time. You know, and I said, but it was the first year they start processing meat.
Mm.
Which I thought was interesting. You know.
Right.
Because a lot of people are saying, well, when the meat is that exactly, is just the way all the chemicals they put in the meat nowadays.
Right.
So that you're seeing a lot of young girls around 12 or 13 developing, looking like they about 20, 21, 22, you know. And there's a lot of the hormones, like in the milk, especially those fast food restaurants like McDonald's, Burger King, Steak and Shake. They put a lot of hormones in those foods. And I'm like, you know, this conspiracy is so vast and so widely spread, you know. I mean, sometimes you think to myself, well, how can you stop it?
Well, we know that, you know, that the great creative source left us with certain blueprints, which is called plants, in which that has the ability in order to heal the body and re-alkalize it and give us the ability in order to rejuvenate and revitalize and re-energize ourselves and regenerate ourselves. So herbs in which that will help with that, with those particular cases would be the blood cleansing herbs such as burdock, red clover, yellow dock, patiaco, echinacea, golden seal, chaparral, yellow dock, chicory. You know, these are the herbs on which that you must use on a daily basis based on the environment. You must take cleanses every day.
Echinacea and golden seal.
Right.
Okay, I used to take those two on a daily basis, but I haven't been quite some time. But I'm going to start back. Since you said I'm going to start back on the way you explained it, I'm going to start back doing that. As soon as possible, maybe starting tomorrow.
Right, and add cayenne pepper in because much gluten and these Morgellon bacteria, they act as like glue to the bloodstream. So you have to be able to break that up, and cayenne pepper are some of the ones in which that breaks that up, you know, because it acts as an irritant to the digestive system, you know. So ginger and cayenne pepper are good to add to the regimen in order to improve the circulation and the blood flow.
Okay. Along with the golden seal as well?
Right.
Golden seal, echinacea. What do you think about saw palmetto?
Yeah, saw palmetto is good for the reproductive and the prostate gland particularly.
Okay.
Right, but you have to take large amounts of saw palmetto for it can actually work very well. So add Damiana to it.
Okay, so that means I must drink a lot of water.
Right, water in which that at least is pH balance of your blood, which is 7.4.
Okay, gotcha.
Or slightly higher.
Okay, gotcha. Because I was dealing with people like the vegans and vegetarians, and they were saying something like, but I was telling them Monsanto. I was trying to move in to a lot of your vegetarian foods.
And they didn't try. They did.
They did.
Whole right now is being ran by Monsanto.
Okay. Cause I told
so
them they
soon
gotta,
you will. I mean, but I already seen seedless watermelons and seedless grapes and seedless, foods. I already seen all of this in Whole Foods years ago, back in the 90s. And I was questioning then, why they got this shit in the organic section, and organic means living, and this shit don't have any seeds, which gives life.
Right. How are they growing them without the seeds?
Exactly. So I was already suspicious anyway of Whole Foods, you know, 360 Whole Foods. You know, I was already suspect, you know.
Okay.
And so now that they finally went on ahead and gave, the banner over to Monsanto isn't surprising to me.
Hmm.
Because you can't have seedless anything in the organic section.
Yeah, no, you cannot. Because I know they had shut down a health food grocery store. They shut them down. And I asked them why they were shut down, because they were giving classes in the evening on certain foods that you shouldn't eat, you know, that you can't eat, something that you shouldn't eat. And I said, and they said, well, they were doing what was right. That's what it was.
Mm.
And they shut them down.
Yeah.
I said, the other organic stores are open, you know. Why this particular one? Because then there was some people saying, because that was the only one that was doing that they were supposed to do. They were doing something right.
Yeah. And that was keeping the foods actually organic.
That's what that they told me. That's what that was.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's something, you know. But I was looking at the tsunami disaster, certain disasters like the nuclear reactor in Japan, and I was thinking, was that by design also?
Of course, it was. That was part of the radiation process in which that was part of an attempt in order to once again to shut down the DNA, you know, from mutating, you know, having to deal with radiation poisoning, you know, would have to put a strain on the DNA from being able to mutate to the next level of consciousness and awareness. So what happens is that now your body is fighting. You know, it's fighting to get rid of the poison. And if you don't know the herbs in order to use in order to do so, then you'll fall right into it. So kelp is good. Spirulina.
Okay.
Corella is excellent. Matter of fact, during World War II, when Hiroshima and Nagasaki got bombed in Japan, the Japanese people used corella in order to heal themselves, which has the highest amount of chlorophyll in it. And chlorophyll is known to be an agent in order to cleanse the blood, because it has the same component as your blood. Matter of fact, your blood and chlorophyll, which is actually melanin, is almost identical. There's only one difference in that, and that's the an iron molecule and a magnesium molecule. Magnesium is at the core of the chlorophyll, Well, iron is at the core of our blood.
But that's Corilla, I heard you use that. You told me that earlier, didn't you?
No.
Anatomist Corilla.
Yeah, Corilla, spirulina, iris sea moss, kelp.
Okay. Those,
right. All of these are herbs in which that helps with removing radiation from the body. Alfalfa is good too. Dandelion. You remove radiation. And we need to be taking one of those or several of those on a daily basis too.
Okay. I'll remember that.
In order
write
to
that
clean
down.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to write that down. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, also, do you think that HAARP had anything to do with those nuclear reactors acting up the way it did, or?
Well, as far as the way that it was able to spread out after it happened, yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And I think that's probably part of the plan on why so many scientists have been eliminated. We have over 22 scientists from Great Britain in which that's been killed. We've had over 530 Iraqi scientists to be killed by the Israeli Mossad. This thing is big, you know.
Man.
What is it that they're trying to hide by killing, hundreds and hundreds of scientists?
That is something.
Mm-hmm.
Israeli Mossad. That's some. That's an organization the news never talk about.
Oh no, they don't. No, they talk that. Yeah, you're right. They'll never talk about them.
They'll never talk about that. They never talk about. You said when you first opened up your show this evening, you said about the media and the news. They never talk about or tell the public or the people about. You know, you open up some topics that most people don't hear about, and you're right, don't hear about them.
Right.
And the media is being told to tell people what they want them to know and what they don't want them to know.
Right. Matter of fact, in the article, this is what it says. It says right here that it says at least 350 Iraqi scientists and more than 200 university professors and academia personalities have been killed by the Israeli Mossad. According to the report, which was referred to the United States President George Bush, Mossad agents have been operating in Iraq with the aim of liquidating Iraqi nuclear and biology scientists, according to other scientists and predominantly university professors. That was after the United States failed to persuade those scientists to cooperate with or work for it. The Iraqi commandos has been operating on the Iraqi territory for more than a year. So the commandos was working on the Iraqi territory for more than a year. The focus of the activities being the assassination of the Iraqi scientists and intellectuals. The Zionist reports that the large-scale assassination campaign after the failure of the American effort that started immediately after American occupation of Iraq aimed at the attraction of number of Iraqi scientists to cooperate or go to work for in the United States. Then it goes on and says that some Iraqi scientists were forced to work in America's research centers. However, the majority of them refused to cooperate in certain fields and fled the United States to other countries. It further states that the Pentagon agrees with the suggestion of the Mossad, which believes that the best way to get rid of those scientists was to physically eliminate them.
Hmm. Hmm. So therefore, the Iranian scientists better watch out then.
Basically.
Iran, because they don't like the idea that Iran, they talk about the nuclear weapons, but it's not so much about the nuclear weapons so much, is that Iran has their own nuclear energy now, so they don't have to depend on Western resources.
Exactly.
And that's what it's really all about, I believe.
It definitely is. Definitely is. No doubt about it.
Because they were talking about, Harold Obama talking about, they have developed them to weapons of mass destruction, and things of that nature, but actually is about them not depending upon more use of Western resources. And also, Iran is money being backed by gold, and the monetary system, the Western monetary system, has a problem with that also. So that's another, what they say, a stone in their shoe.
Right. And this goes back to what we were talking about earlier, is that we had the AIDS plague in the 20th century. Now we have the Magellan plague in the 21st century. So here it was that AIDS was the thing 20 years ago, you know, 20 or 30 years ago was the main thing. You know, 1983, 84 is when it appeared in New York City, you know, amongst, you know, over 400 to 700 male Trojans who was actually gays.
Right.
And that's why they reported that it was a gay disease.
Right.
You know, and then when it appeared in Africa during the same time period, around the same time, they said that a monkey bit a nigga in his ass. And this is... I mean, this is the this is what they said. You can look this shit up. This is factual. That
and it's
monkey,
amazing that the people really
right.
believe that.
Yes, a rhesus monkey.
That bullshit. You know, you know.
This is what it says, that a rhesus monkey bit a African in his backside and contracted HIV, in which that led to AIDS complications. Because you really know that no one actually dies of AIDS. You die of the complication of AIDS, which means pneumonia or bronchitis or asthma or, you know, pneumonia or, you know, cancer. You die of complications. No one has ever died of AIDS.
Okay.
This is why they say that AIDS is a hoax, is because no one ever died from it. You die of complications of it. If you was able to control the complications or prevent the complications, then you don't have AIDS.
And that's something?
You know, I mean,
really,
if you don't, if people don't want to believe that, let's look at Magic Johnson.
Yeah, he looks healthy to me.
It's 25 years running.
You know, because according to what they're talking about, he should have been gone.
That's, supposedly. Look like he's still buying up shit to me. So we know that this is the nonsense in which that is being perpetrated, you know, on the population. You know, and it's part of population control agenda. All of this is the war on humanity. You know what I'm saying? We're talking about the war on drugs. We're talking about the war on terror. No, it's the war on humanity.
Exactly.
Because they
exactly.
are what humanity may do, that we may mutate and become super Homo sapiens sapien, beyond Homo sapiens sapien to Homo Christos,
mm-hmm.
right? Which is the next evolution stage for the people. This is where it goes into the indigo children, the rainbow children, the crystal children, and so forth and so on. You know, children who are being born with more than just two strands of DNA, that there's extra codons on which that is coming online and so forth and so on, and children being born with three strands of DNA, and that originally we had 12 strands of DNA, and that the other 10 strands are now part of junk DNA, but now scientists have gone and tested the junk DNA and found that junk DNA is now becoming reactivated. So now all of these things are occurring, so now they have to stop it. So what you do, you make frankenfood, which is genetically altered food, which is GMOs, genetically modified organisms, in order
what
to
about,
go in and supplant.
What about tofu?
Tofu is part of that same plan. Tofu has too much estrogen in for the male body. You don't need tofu.
I thought so.
Too much estrogen. Matter of fact, that's how white women now have ass. 20 years ago, they didn't have ass. That shit was flatter than a pancake.
Yeah, I know. I've been noticing for the last 20 years.
Right. Now, all of a sudden, being that they changed the oil within the majority of the foods in the supermarket, if you don't believe me, go and check. Remember, when we was younger, they used coconut oil. They used peanut oil. They used canola oil. Now,
right.
or, you know, now the only oil that you see that they're using is soybean oil. Now, okay. Oil turns to when it goes into the body. It turns to...
One brother tried to tell me it depends on what kind of soy food you eat.
No. Soybean oil itself, period, being that it's in soybean, being it has high amounts of estrogen, oil turns to fat in the body. Where is fat stored at in the woman's body? It's in the breast, it's in the hips, buttocks, and the thighs.
Okay.
So all of a sudden, now we're seeing, you know, miraculously, you know, behinds on white women.
White women. You're right too.
And this
right.
is part of the same scenario in which that is going on. You know what I'm saying? Now, so we know that just these minor things or minor changes affects the human body. Just that one change, putting soybean oil in the major products in the supermarket has produced that change within the physiology of the body.
See,
now we're talking about chemtrails, we're talking about frankenfood and all these other things taking place. What is it doing to our bodies?
Exactly.
I'm seeing more obesity.
I am too. Especially among well, men, but among women too.
Right.
Young. I mean, they're young.
Right.
They make it so bad. They're so young. And I see them among high school girls.
Right.
I mean, man, you know, it's going to become a real serious problem.
It is. It's a real serious problem now. So it changed to help them develop body. But it changed in order to destroy or degenerate our bodies.
Okay.
All right.
Okay,
this is what the food is doing to us. And so the GMO's code is suppressing our DNA. And then we have other things in which that is suppressing the DNA, such as the chemtrails. When you do your research on the chemtrails, the bacteria spores that's in the chemtrails particularly affect our DNA.
So you said about the soy food, it does what now? I told you about the brother was trying to explain to me that it depends on what kind of soy food you eat. So you
right,
said that's not true. That's not. So you were saying that's not true.
No, because soy products, period, according to Natural Magazine, you do your research, you'll find that soybean has high amount of estrogen. Estrogen is a female hormone. Why would men have, what happens when men take in female hormones?
Oh, man, their chest getting, look like it's not the way it's supposed to look.
Exactly. He grows breasts, or titties, as we would say. His penis shrink, his testicles shrink.
Man.
So, of course, you will have prostate gland problems.
Wow. Hmm. I have to tell you, I'll talk to that brother again then.
Mm-hmm.
He's a brother that knows a lot about, thinks he knows about holistic health. And he's into it, but this is one part he don't know. So I definitely got to talk to him again.
Well, just go and do your research before you talk to him. Just go and do your research, and you'll see how... soybeans has high amounts of estrogen.
Okay. Another thing about what else you were talking about that you was going to touch on back to the mind control thing.
Right.
Got the MK Ultra, which means mind control ultra.
Right.
I found out I had read a book. It was about by a Dr. Coleman, I think, and it's dealing with the Tavistock Institution.
Right, exactly.
And for years, they had been, I think, since before World War One, they had did a lot of research, even on their own soldiers. You know, what makes, they know what part of the brain makes us tick.
Right. Well, that was the whole purpose of the CIA putting the LSD out during the 60s and the 70s, was to see what would take place. You know, how the drugs would be mind-altering.
Mm-hmm.
And when it was mind-altering for the positive, you know, they had to go on and take that on off the market.
Okay.
You know, I mean, you go back and do your research, Funkadelic and Parliament, I mean, George Clinton and them, they was using LSD.
Okay, I heard about that.
Yeah. Different
I heard
groups.
About that.
The street during the time, and music was using LSD, and he was coming out with all types of music in which that was just like tapping into the subconscious.
Because the Funkadelics them had to been part of the conspiracy too, of mind control.
Well, it's I can't say how far it goes, but I definitely say that you have the Monarch experiments in which that definitely took place, in which that dealt with the people in the music industry as well as also within the acting field. And we know that they are mind control agents or sex slaves, you know, based on especially now current events in which that is taking place. I was just with Professor Griff a couple of weeks ago, and he spoke about how Clyde Davis was having sex with Whitney Houston and how she had two abortions.
What?
Yeah. From Clyde Davis. Because Clyde Davis was her handler.
That's something.
So when he couldn't use her any longer, he killed her. Had her killed. And now he has her replacement, which is Jennifer Hudson.
Hudson?
Yeah.
I heard some things about her, too.
Oh, yeah. Her family got killed about 4 or 5 years ago. The whole family. A mother, a brother, and nephew.
I wonder why did not anything happen to her?
Her sister is out partying and nothing happens to her. Well, guess what? The father of the boy says that it was part of Jennifer Hudson's satanic ritual to get into the industry, to get high up into the industry, to be in the $100 million club industry.
So she sold her family out?
And killed them. And they got, and had them satanically ritualized and sacrificed, blood sacrifice.
And what kind of person is Jennifer Hudson?
A black devil.
Man.
So these are the things in which that we have to, you know, look at.
I know dealing with instruments like television, I notice a lot of times the children be sitting in front of the television. Sometimes, like my niece, I kept on saying something to her. She was about 7 to 8 years old. And I hear her mother say something to her. I kept on saying something to her, and she just seemed like she was glued to that television.
Oh, yeah. Well, over 10 years ago, there was an experiment that was done in Japan in which that they had Pokemon in which that a red flash.
Yeah, she loved Pokemon.
Right, but a red flash came across the screen, and it caused over 400 children to go to the be hospitalized.
Man, that's something.
Yeah, so that TV can be also utilized as a mind control tool or agent. I mean, there's no reason. I mean, look at it. Why they call the TV episodes programs?
I know sometimes when I go out to dump the trash and I look at people's windows and it'd be dark in there, but I could tell they have their TVs on. And it looks like I see a lot of flashes flickering.
Mm-hmm.
Not flickering, flashes.
Right.
But they change
the frequency band so that it can be more easily mind controlled, for the people can be more easily mind controlled. They moved the band from 24 bands to 36 bands.
I know, I was hearing that Sister Myra Eel was saying that she was giving a lecture, And she talked to the audience. She said, now, those of you that watch a lot of television, you may fall asleep when I'm trying to give this lecture. And first I wondered, what she's talking about? You know, she said, now, she said, what I'm talking about is, if you watch a lot of television, most of you are mind controlled already and you don't know it. Because they said, if you just get in a dark room, that's nothing but the TV. She explained it.
Right.
And you see a lot of flickering.
Right.
What it does, it holds your attention span only for 60 seconds. And I'm like, wow. I'm like, wow.
Oh, yeah.
And that's some really deep science. When you come in and spend all this effort and energy to control the minds of the people of the world like that.
Oh, yeah. Well, we know that they put subliminal messages underlaying in the music and in the movies. So the subliminal messages, like, for example, I can tell you about one when the frequency band was on 24 frames per second instead of 36. At 24, which is supposedly high definition, now it's 36. That's why it's supposed to be high definition and the reason why they had to change from analog to digital. All right. When it was analog TV, basically, it was dealing with channel 2 to channel 13, which was very high frequency, and then 14 to 83, which was ultra high frequency. You know, and it dealt with the various antennas. You had the rabbit ear antennas, and then you had the ohm antenna on the
right.
back. Now, when we had those type of TVs, all right, which was still within the mid 90s. I remember working at LabCorp, and I was a lieutenant security there. And it was around 3 o'clock, 3:30 in the morning, and it was like the TV went offline. It was getting ready to go offline, and I was dozing off. I was still able to hear what was going on, but I was still drifting.
Uh-huh.
What came across the TV was Lord Maitreya. He is here. I popped the hell up out that, you know, trance because I looked around and like, how the hell are they communicating that? Then I looked at the TV. They're communicating that shit through the frequency bands of the TV.
Huh.
And it was saying Lord Maitreya is here. And this is exactly what was said.
Huh.
And it was in 1996. So now, you know, they changed it from analog to digital. So now it becomes even more easier being with the change in frequency bands to now from 24 to 36 to encode subliminal messages such as that and to get more people to listen. And if you notice, that didn't change until Obama came into office in July of 2008.
Okay.
Is when the change from analog to digital came into effect.
That's another big deception, Obama.
Yeah, well, that's what's going on, too. It's no coincidence that after the frequency change, all of a sudden, the commercials for Lord Maitreya started coming on TV in November of 2008, going into 2009.
Wow. Man, people something else.
Oh, yeah. So, Lord Maitreya was having commercials come on TV, and it was all over the TV. They was on A&E, History Channel, National Geographic's Channel, Sci-Fi Channel. It was on all, even on CNN, C-SPAN. These commercials on Lord Maitreya was popping all up. And it was saying that if you have seen these lights in the sky, they are images and symbols of the one who will reappear. And it's Lord Maitreya, the world savior.
Hmm.
This is what was said during the commercials.
Hmm.
Now, I've looked and looked all over the damn internet trying to find these damn commercials, and I cannot find them.
They took them off.
Okay. So, this was part of their mind control. Now, you get this book called Global Tyranny by the John Burke Society. I know John Burke Society, you know, and their racist views, however, still get the book called Global Tyranny. in the book, it shows how Lord Maitreya was on a boat with George Bush and different other ones during the 80s and 90s. So he's supposed to be the world religion savior, or the religious figure of the New Age.
Okay.
This is what they're trying to make him into. But not many people know about him as of yet.
Well, I thought they were going to choose T.D. Jakes.
Nah, T.D. Jakes don't have the charisma for that. I mean, he might be able to, you know, pull 20,000 people into his auditorium. And that's a feat within itself. So I can't disrespect that feat. You know, however, I know if I was teaching that same nonsense, I would have 30 million just like... You know, I would have 30,000 listeners just like him, Joel Osteen, and Creflo Dollar, too.
Okay. I hear about him, and I know he's supposed to be an ex-homosexual. T.D. Jakes. T.D. Jakes, that's what I heard.
Oh, I ain't know that.
That's what I heard about T.D. Jakes.
Okay.
Before I'm a homosexual. That's what I heard, but I haven't heard anything from... Billy Graham's son for a while.
Right.
I haven't heard him. I thought he was supposed to take the place of his father.
Yeah, but, I mean, right now, Joel Osteen is holding it down for everybody. He got over 30,000 people in his big behind auditorium.
Mm.
You know, I mean, it's ridiculous.
Mm. And you got the people just mind control.
Oh, yeah. And truthfully, his message is better than T.D. Jakes and Creflo Dollar put together. You know, so, I mean, based on his message, you know, I see why he got 30,000. Because his message is more universal. It's not based on separation.
Okay. Okay.
But he's one of the top mind controllers in the industry, and he has an innocent face. He has that twinkle in his eye. He has that voice in which, well, my father told me when I was a boy, you know, and so, I mean, all for that shit.
And they fall for it.
Mine is sinker. They fall for it, Brother Wilterin, I'm telling you. And so, I mean, you know, you have somebody who can, you know, appear to be that humble and be that sincere, you know what I'm saying? You're going to draw multitudes to you, you know. So, when you listen to him, you know, you can feel like, you know, there's something that's there that you're trying to analyze, but you just can't put your finger on it, you know, somewhat. You know, you know that he inherited his ministry from his father. You know, like his son. Well, Joel Osteen got it from his father.
Mm. Going down generation to generation.
Right, exactly. You know, nepotism at its best.
So they teach the young ones, and then they take over when they leave.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, this is what they do. I mean. And based on, you know, things in which that when they are put into a trust, I mean, that's the only logic is to be able to appoint someone who can keep the trust going, you know, who can act as a trustee, you know. So, I mean, this is actually what is going on, and we're seeing examples of this over and over again. Whether you look at the Rockefeller family or whether you look at Joel Osteen and his father in a way in which that they did their thing.
Speaking of the Rockefeller family, I was surprised. I read this book called The Rothschild Dynasty, and I was surprised that the Rothschilds were the one that put the Rockefellers on their feet.
Right.
I was surprised because I thought the Rothschilds, I mean, the Rockefellers were really the...
No, the Rothschilds are.
Okay.
Right. They the ones who was the financiers or the Jewish bankers. For the Vatican. This is how they got put on their feet, was through the Vatican, the Rothschilds.
Okay.
This is how they went on to control Eastern Europe. and spread out their tentacles into Asia and throughout Africa, through Cecil Rhodes and through others.
That's what you call one powerful family.
Right. So, I mean, now you look at them being the Jewish financiers or the convert Jews, they converted Jews and being the financiers of the Pope, of the Vatican.
The financiers of the Pope?
Right. They was the financiers for the Pope. So the Pope put them on.
Mm.
And they put the Rockefellers on. So where's the power coming from?
Man.
The power is coming from the Vatican.
Okay.
You know, Phil Valentine speaks about that a lot. And I have to agree with him that every time I keep going back to the masters of mind control as far as throughout religion, it's them, the Vatican. They're the ones who authorized the image of the beast through Michelangelo
Okay.
You know, with the Sistine Chapel up under Pope Justinian. You know, which was the image of Caesar Borgia.
Hmm.
You know, in which that was a ripoff from the Serapis image from the 325 AD up under Constantine.
Right.
You know, and the 318 bishops who decided on this created image, in which that Arian said, I'm not going with this created image, this created creature, yo. I'm not rolling with it. And they excommunicated him from the proceedings.
Hmm.
So we see how it came on. And, of course, people can get Walter Williams' book. We had him on here a couple of weeks ago, in which that he spoke on the Vatican manipulation of these particular proceedings and councils, as well as also the initiation of Islam. And you get that from his book, Historical Origin of Christianity and Historical Origin of Christianity of Islam.
By the Vatican.
Yeah, the Vatican. This is why they have Fatima. I mean, how can they call Mary, the mother of God, call her Fatima when Fatima was supposed to be the daughter of Muhammad?
That's correct, yeah. You're right, Tumor, because a brother told me that. And he said, well, Christianity and Judaism, then he said Islam, is also, is pay homage to the Vatican. I said, how's that? You know, I thought Islam and the Vatican were enemies. He said, no. They put you in the people's minds,
right,
and get the image, mix out, make an image in the belief,
right,
that they are enemies, but they're not. They
are
all tied into one.
Right. They needed something in which that will hold as a religion or mind control tool for the Arabs, for those many tribes in which that would unify them under their rulership, and it became Islam.
So that's why the Prophet Noble Jawali, he called our religion Islamism.
Right.
Trying to separate, trying to get us away from that.
Right, which is the old tongue religion, which is talking about the ancient mysteries of Egypt, why he was calling an Egyptian adept.
Okay.
He wanted us to go back to ancient Egypt, because that is where the Vatican got their power from, was imitating our ancestry from there. The Pope wears his crown, the Dogon crown, which is the crown of Osiris, or Osar. But he wears the yarmulke, which is the headdress or the skull cap of Ptah, the father of the gods, or the Netzer of the Netzerus.
Or like the prayer cap of the Islamic prayer cap?
Right.
That's what Muslims wear?
Right. The kufi, the yarmulke, is the same type of headdress in which that the Pope wears too. That comes from Ptah.
Okay.
Who was a Twa. And he was the father of the gods, the Netzer of the Netzerus, or the Netzer of the Netzerus.
Mm.
So the imitation of everything that they have, Mary is nothing more than Osset or Isis. Their god, in which they refer to as God, is Osar or Osiris. Their son is Heru, which is they transform to Jesus. Joseph is Seb or Geb, becomes Gabriel, the archangel, who comes to the, who's the messenger of God, who comes to Earth. So, I mean, their whole theology is the ancient mysteries encoded and then perverted and spread out throughout the world to become the different denominations that we see later on through the Martin Luther and through the John Calvinism, in which that called a Protestant movement, in which that you get the Pentecostal Holiness, Jehovah Witness, the Baptist, the Methodist, the Pentecostal Holiness, the Holy Rollers, you know, the Episcopalian, you know, all of them. That came from the Protestant movement, but that was through the Catholic Church.
The Catholic Church came through
the Catholic. There is no Protestant movement or any of those churches unless it came through the Catholic Church. So where did the Catholic Church get their information from? Ancient Egypt. Where did the Prophet Noble Jolly was leading us back to? The old-time religion, Islamism, ancient Egypt. Why he was called an Egyptian adept. And why he said he had, why he was a universal prophet.
Okay. So that better explains his teachings.
Right. And what makes it so bad is that many can't, but yet claim to be Moors, and then get upset at you and I having a conversation such as this.
Yeah, we do.
You know, so, I mean, this is the nonsense that's being perpetrated against those who's trying to find out truth and those who are mind controlled themselves.
Yeah, every time I bring that up in the temples, I get resistance.
Oh, yeah. You keep getting resistance is because they don't want to deal with those issues. When the issues are very simple and is right in the lessons.
But they don't. When I say that, when I say stuff like that, like what you be talking about, and I try to bring it to them, it sounds foreign to them.
Mm-hmm.
Very foreign. And a lot of them claim that's not more science.
I don't know how. Science means to know. And
right.
More is, sure, more is in many things, really. The description of a Moor is that of one of Arab or African or Afro lineage. And when we talk about Arab, we're not talking about the pale Arabs. We're talking about the original Arabs, who are the Kushites, which that now is called Sudan and Ethiopia and Somalia, down into Kenya and Uganda.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was looking at a report, a chalkboard he wrote on one Sunday school, where they said that Moore Science Temple does not teach sovereign citizenship.
Well,
and,
how
are they going to talk about nationality,
right,
and birthright, and they won't talk about sovereignty? That's what I didn't understand.
Well, the word sovereign means to have, basically to be king. You know, king.
I don't think
there's
wrong with that.
King to means one who is able to define, you know. So to them, that's an evil thing because I could have sworn that Allah is in man. So when you told me that Allah is in man, then I became sovereign at that very instant when I realized that. Because Allah is in man. That is sovereignty. That's what makes me king. Because Allah is in my flesh, is in his temple.
Right. Right. But that means also when they speak of nationality and birthright, they don't really know how deep that goes.
Exactly.
They don't really understand what they be teaching.
Right.
When one says, I want to proclaim my nationality and birthright.
Right.
Okay, they come down and get their card and everything.
Mm-hmm.
And, but then, that's it, you know. They don't go any further than that.
Right.
They don't give them any papers or nothing to get their papers notarized. Or
I think the reason why they don't want you to know is because they want you to go through that death chamber. So, you see, according to the teachings, you're not supposed to teach that depth chamber lessons to the members unless they have gone through that depth chamber.
Oh, okay.
So that's the reason why they don't teach y'all what y'all supposed to know. But in our temple, in the Moorish Holy Temple of Science of the world, we can't do that. We can't leave y'all out there letting y'all just think that all this stuff is literal when we know that is allegorical. And you need to teach this information to your children.
Right.
What would it look like for me to let you think that Moses split the Red Sea instead of just talking about your blood supply and your blood system and your body? And the heart is what splits the blood or the Red Sea, which is symbolic to Moses.
So they don't teach you like that. No, they say because a lot of the Moors may not never go to their death chamber, you know?
Exactly. And that's the problem. And even when you go to the death chamber, there's three heavens, first, second, and third heaven. So it's the same as within Freemasonry, first, second, and third degree. And so apprentice, fellow craftsman, and master mason.
I said, oh, because I wonder what a lot of stuff I'd be saying. Because I don't know until you told me.
That's the reason why they want to know how you know. I'm going to teach you the truth.
Okay.
I don't have a choice. We're not taught the whole secrets in our temple structure, brother. In the Moorish Holy Temple Science of the world, we don't hold secrets. We teach you the science of life and how it applies. Those scriptures are applied to your physical body.
Right. Right. That's the beautiful thing about it. You know.
Right.
The only thing about it.
When you tell me that Allah is in man, that's all I need to know.
Right.
Everything personally, everything else becomes irrelevant.
You know, it's...
It becomes an afterthought.
No, because I I told them that I was I'm a Ouachita Moor, you know, because I didn't want to have that.
Right. Well, let's look at the word Ouachita. All right, this is for all those who are Ouachita, as well as those who might have studied or heard that word before. The word Ouachita comes from the word Ouachita. Ouachita is the ancient Egyptian word for reaching the epitome of enlightenment. When you see the caduceus or the uraeus, and you see the serpents coming up, the spinal column, which is that pillar in the middle, those snakes, the Eden of Pingala, or Osset and Nephet, those two symbolize the same pillars within Masonry, which is known as Boaz and Jassim.
Okay.
At the middle pillar. The middle pillar symbolizes your spinal column, or you. And spinal column is that middle column that comes up. That's the spinal column. And within that spinal column, there's 33 vertebrates. Hence the 33 degrees of Freemasonry.
Okay.
And when you reach the 33rd degree, they call the sovereign inspector general. So you are sovereign once you reach the 33 degrees. Beforehand, you're not.
Okay, the Ouachita is Ouachita, you said?
It's Ouachita, right. Ouachita.
Okay. That started with a U?
Yeah, they normally started out with a U, but, you know, the U and the W is actually replaceable.
Okay.
Just like the M and the N. Just like the L and the R.
Okay.
Okay.
Gotcha. Okay. Because he didn't object to that. You know, I thought I would hear some feedback behind it, but I didn't.
Right, right.
And some more told me something he probably may not never heard of Ouachita Moors.
Well, put it this way, brother. You have a lot of grand sheiks and others in the temple who have seen my lectures and information, but they won't speak that information in because they know that they would get shut down just like you.
Okay.
But you go and tell them this information that I'm talking about, and they're either going to run, which I've had. When I dropped this information on Grand Sheiks and on Grand Governors, I mean, they actually literally ran out my store.
Wow.
And they're supposed to have been there. This was 10 years ago. They actually supposed to have been there in order to interview me, in order to put me in a Grand Sheik position. You know, but we
they
still open up our Moorish Holy Temple of Signs of the World anyway. you know, in 2005. You know, but in 2002, 2003, they came to the store in order to, you know, give me some feedback on being a member of the Morris Science Temple of America. And this was now, there was brothers from out of Lumberton area in North Carolina, and they was under at the time, all right, because I think All Love Ill. Right. Now, I came under his teachings back in 88, 89. But in 2002, that's when the Grand Sheik and the Grand Governor came to me in order to, I mean, basically, they already felt like I was already in the Adept Chamber information. So they just basically just left me alone and went on their way. But I'm like, dang, you could, but they kept sending, you know, the brother who was going through that Adept Chamber to me in order to learn and get information.
Evidently, they felt they weren't qualified enough.
No, well, I mean, basically, they felt like we was on the same level of information in a sense.
Okay.
I knew the same things that they knew. They knew what I knew, you know, so it was like, well, what can we teach you, in a sense? You know what I'm saying? I guess maybe that's how they felt. I can't say for sure. But, you know, regardless, 2-3 years later, I became a Grand Sheik under the Morris Holy Temple of Science of the World, thanks to Grand Sheik Jelani Bey and National Grand Sheik Adar Bey,
okay.
You know, who was up under Brother Anderson Ill from out of Richmond, Virginia, from his Morris Holy Temple of Science, in which that you will find that there was two Morris Holy Temple of Science in which that was never changed, even with the change in 1928 by Prophet Obadiah Ali. One was out of West Virginia, in which Morris Holy Temple of Science, Morris Holy Temple of Science, and there was another one out of New Jersey in which that was still a Morris Holy Temple of Science.
Okay.
So there was still Morris Holy Temple of Sciences that still existed, even with the change of the Morris Holy Temple of Science to the Morris Science Temple of America.
Because I noticed a lot of them don't associate with me. I only
Who's
have
that?
One at the temple I go to here in number 5
mm-hmm.
in St. Louis. They don't associate. The Grand Sheik only called me one time since I've been a member of that temple.
Mm-hmm.
And I was approached by the Grand Governor that they he's planning on calling me to give a lecture on Holy Day Friday,
mm-hmm.
which I was surprised,
right?
Because I didn't think they wanted to, you know, hear none of that because they know how I give lectures,
right?
So I don't know whether they tried to find out how much I do know.
Yeah, well, I mean, there's no problem with that. I mean, they want to see if you probably could be ready to go to the Adept Chamber and get additional information as possible. You know, I'm not going to read their minds and say what is what, but you have to go definitely through the experience in order to confirm it to yourself.
Okay.
You know, that's what I would do.
Okay.
You know, so this is what is going on. And so these are the issues in which that is within the temple structure. And this is I'm doing this generally. This is not specific, so please don't get offended. You know, I'm not talking about specifics because there are temples in which that, you know, teach what they're supposed to be teaching.
Uh-huh.
And then there's others in which that is still based on hand clapping and singing.
Yeah, and I see a lot. I see that.
Right, and that's just the truth of the matter. I mean, they turned the temple into a church.
Yeah, because they're using gospel songs of church music, and then in place of
right.
Muslim words or terms.
Right, right, and then put Obadiah Ali in there.
Because I heard one song called "Way in the Water," "Way in the Water," Muslims, "Way in the Water." Prophet Obadiah Ali is going to something, you know, and I said, wait a minute, you know, that's
right.
A church song, but they.
Well, I mean, we would say that they church songs, but those are gospels. you know, or Dr. York used to refer to them as ghost spells.
Okay.
Because they're old Negro spirituals. And, you know, and the Negro spirituals came out of the fields, not in the church. They came from the brothers and sisters who was working, you know, who was not the house niggas, but was the field niggas, or field Negroes, and who worked outside from sun up to sundown. And they came up with those particular tunes, and they took them into the church setting.
Okay.
You know, so there's nothing wrong with utilizing them in a sense. You know what I'm saying? Because we need to put spells on ourselves in order to make sure that we're doing proper things. You know, and, you know, they utilize what they still had, which is tunes or songs, you know, from those particular old spiritual, you know, handbooks, you know, and, you know, I don't see too much wrong with that. However, I'm just saying that there's a little bit too much of it going on instead of the real teachings in which that people need to know so that they won't look at it as just a social event or fellowshipping like they
right.
do in church. But actually come away with something of substance.
Right. Well, like you said, they want you to go to the adept chamber to learn that. In
right.
order for you to learn that those teachers, you got to go to the adept chamber. And it seems like
right.
they're
but then
cheating
you can't,
a lot of the other ones out of knowledge,
right.
you know.
Right, but then you can't tell no one.
Then you can't tell no one. Oh, what?
Oh,
no, I didn't know they had it like that.
Right, you can't tell the members of your congregation.
Well, in that case, they're misleading the Moors then.
And that's the problem. If you're going to still do the same Masonic, you know, practices in which that you claim that you're not part of, but still do it in something in which that's supposed to be different from it, then you can't really say that there's a difference.
No, you
because
can't.
Because the same tactics are being used. That if you haven't come to a certain level of consciousness or awareness, then I can't tell you what's going on. You have to speculate or guess. Or you have to go through the adept chamber when you get, or when we say that you're ready. When we say that you're ready. Not when you feel that you're ready.
Okay, yeah. The thing is to get me into the adept chamber to shut me up.
That's what they do in masonry.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know,
sure
like,
do.
Like, for example, they would probably want me to shut up based on how much information I teach, and so they would try to recruit me.
Okay.
So that I can be, so when I take a particular oath, you know, I would have to be quiet based on whatever they tell me I can only speak on.
Okay. I didn't know the adapt camera was like that.
Yeah.
So there's no telling what the Grand Sheik or the Sheik know in.
Exactly. And that's my point. But he can't have you going around telling others adept chamber information, and he can't.
I got you. That's the problem.
Right.
That's the problem.
Right.
But,
but see, this is the reason why they have a problem with me and Taj.
Okay.
And Hakeem Bey is because we teach that depth chamber information.
But actually, you're teaching more science, Temple of the World information.
You got it.
But it ain't got nothing to do with the more science, Temple of America.
Not in a sense, because we came before it. We actually have the same original name in which that Prophet Nobadra Ali was using, and which was still utilized actually all the way up until 1934. Even up under Charles Kirkman Bay, in which that Robert Lavelle and them came from up under Charles Kirkman Bay. And Charles Kirkman Bay had the Moorish Science Temple of America and the Moorish Holy Temple of Science, both of them running together all the way up until 1934. So if the Moorish Holy Temple of Science supposed to have been disbanded, then that should have been something in which that was done during the time of Prophet Nobadra Ali. How was it possible that Charles Kirkman Bay still utilized it 5 years after the death of Prophet Nobadra Ali?
Huh.
And what was it that they was trying to hide? Obviously the civic side, because one is religious and one is civic.
Huh. So one of the chairman or whatever says that the circle seven is written as meant literally what it means. So that's so he know better than that when he said that, right?
Right. He was trying to throw you off the trail, more than likely. If he know he don't really believe that.
Okay. Boy.
He should know that.
Oh well.
Oh yeah.
But how much time we got left?
We got about 4 more minutes, so let me get back to this information.
Okay.
So not only did we have the Mossad, Israeli Mossad, 530 murders of the Iraqi and scientists and professors. We also had the Star Wars and HAARP suicides, over 23 of them in Great Britain. And then we also had a list of over 100, according to Stephen Quayle's website, a list of dead scientists, right during the time of the HAARP system and the chemtrails being orchestrated in the mid-1990s. And this list is over 100 scientists that have died. All right. And, of course, we're talking about that plague in which that comes about, which the AIDS was the plague of the 20th century. Now we have the plague of the 21st century, which is called Magellan. All right. And when you look and do the research on Magellan, it's the multi-infection syndrome. That's what basically Magellan is, because of the broad range and severity of symptoms associated with every Magellan sufferer.
They hardly ever let that out on the news.
Exactly.
Even on CNN.
Right, so this is the reason why this list of over 100 scientists and why they've been killed since the creation and since the upstart of this HAARP and chemtrails, which, like we said, came in the mid 1990s. So all of a sudden, this sickness is now plaguing the people.
Okay, see, I would never known that was going on until you just told me.
Mm-hmm.
Majority of people don't know that's going on.
Right. It's the presence of specific pathogens, microorganisms known as micro cocktails. Microbial cocktails. So it's a cocktail. That's what it is.
Most people don't know that these people are being murdered.
Right. And that is, the reason why the scientists are being murdered is because it's possible because most of these scientists in the United States, or that was part of the United States, this list here, they was most of the ones who was working on AIDS, herpes, bacteria, viruses, polio. In other words, these scientists was microbiologists and biochemists, medical biochemists. So they had to kill them because of their ability in order to possibly be able to cure Magellan, which is the plague which that they attempt to use now in the 21st century. So remember, we was talking about that the military stated when they was asked about these chemtrails, they said it was mass inoculations in which that would vaccinate, supposedly chemtrails are an attempt to vaccinate the entire population against anthrax.
So they always lying as usual.
That's what the military said. Now, remember, in the first list, I told you that more than 25 murders occurred in the 1980s going up into the 1990s of doctors and scientists who worked for Plassey and Marconi, dealt with the designing of the HAARP system.
Are they connected with the anthrax virus?
The anthrax, that was fake.
Okay.
You know, except for those in which that it was sent to. You know, like for, there was governors and senators and congressmen in which that was getting sent anthrax through the mail.
To knock them off.
Right. So there's others who suggest All of the that the government is suspiciously containing concerned that the anthrax would be the method of choice. This is what they're saying, that they think that would be the method of choice. So furthermore, spraying is occurring worldwide. This is what the report says. It says foreign governments are putting money and risk into spraying their prospective populations. Since America would be the target of such an attack, spraying the rest of the world is a waste of money and time. Fact is, biological attacks are too localized an event to account for global spraying. The secrecy of the chemtrails phenomenon puts it into the domain of black budget projects and shadow government operations. It is unwise to claim that the shadow government, the same one responsible for the Gulf War, cover up dangerous biological testing upon unsuspected American citizens. Advocates of fluoride in the public water supply, of course, you know, fluoride is used to dumb down the people. Alternative medicines and technological inventions, electronic harassment. Now, in other words, all of them, you know, and we think that they're going to stop spraying, you know, the people. You know, no, it's part of their population control agenda, once again. You know, so, you know, that is all part of that whole scenario there. And then, of course, we have the fact that we have the Illuminati, you know, cabal fleeing by the hundreds as mass arrests await them from states becoming free from the Federal Reserve. So we found out that the cabal members and their 6,000 or so minions are now quitting their banking positions in the hundreds, as soon to be thousands, because the individual states are filing the proper paperwork to become independent of the United States Corporation owned by the Reserve Bank, who's controlled by the cabal, which means that the United military must obey what the states want and not what the cabal wants. So this is huge. All right, and this is the reason why, you know, Timothy Geithner got arrested back in February the 24th of this year.
Oh, that's the real reason.
Right, Henry Paulson got taken by the MI6 to Bermuda, you know. Plus, there's a whole lot of stuff going on. Now, anybody who knows that, Henry Paulson was the former Treasury Secretary before Timothy Geithner. And matter of fact, he's still pulling strings for Timothy Geithner because all of them are still working for George Bush.
But see, I didn't know that. If you said the 21 states, I didn't know that many of that states were pulling out of the corporation.
Yeah, and that was the last time I checked that there was more than 21 states, exactly.
Well, I didn't know that. So when the show's pretty soon, like I said before and again, pretty soon the game's going to be over.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's the reason why they came, snatched up, you know, the New York police, arrested Timothy Geithner, questioned him, and released him on February the 24th, you know, 2012, just this past year, just a couple of months ago, and a few months ago. According to reports, he was, you know, singing like a goddamn canary. He was spilling his guts about all the corruption and the criminal activities in which that was taking place, so that's going on with Timothy Geithner getting arrested here recently. And then, of course, as we said, being that these 21 states or so have pulled out, and all of a sudden we have Utah pushing to accept gold and silver as alternative currency.
Man.
Utah becomes the first state in the union to accept gold and silver as currency.
It's coming back.
Right.
It's coming back.
And they said 11 other states was considering doing the exact same thing. So that means that that these 6,000 or so, you know, people, you know, who have got who was actually this mass arrest, because it actually was about 100 that was getting mass arrest, and Timothy Geithner was just one of them that got arrested as the states was becoming free from the Federal Reserve Bank. And they're going to use their own gold. And this makes sense because I was thinking, well, how all of a sudden these states got gold when the United States itself don't have any gold, and the gold is there, you know, that was in Fort Knox, is now in the Bank of London, up under the, the Rothschild royal family, as we would say, Queen Elizabeth. You know, I was wondering how that was happening. Well, when you see all these gold commercials on TV,
yeah, I see them.
Buy gold, right? Or we'll give you money for gold. This is how the states was being able to do that. I think that's what they was using to finance their ability in order to pull away.
Hmm. That's good. That's good news, really.
In a sense, we got to see where it's going to go.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Because it's like they're going back to the American Republic.
Right. That's the way that it's looking. So, but they're also talking about being able to, now, of course, you can't, you know, carry around gold and silver in your pockets and just use it.
No,
so what they were talking about was that the quantity or the amount of gold and silver that you have would go upon a credit card, and you'll be able to use your credit card in order to utilize as the form of currency in conjunction with the gold and silver.
Okay.
Okay.
That's how they're going to do it. Okay.
Right. How they're going to do it. Now, that's until they possibly bring up the Amero dollar. Now, if you do any research on the Amero dollar, Amero is backed by silver and gold, too. So I think it's just the fact of them trying to...
Oh, okay. I thought it was going to be like the Federal Reserve notes.
No. No. The Amero dollar actually don't have any faces on them of Europeans. They are like nature. Deers and pyramids and mountains and things like that is on the Amero dollar. They don't have any faces of Europeans on there.
And you said they were backed by gold and silver?
And it's backed by gold and silver. So do your research on that, too. Everybody do your research on that. Let's see what we can come up with because there's a program in which that we're in right now is in which that deals with, we call ourselves the Wealth Builders team.
Okay.
And as the Wealth Builders, what happens is that we purchase 60% off gold and silver. All right? 60%.
Okay.
You know?
I guess that's what I need to start to be doing then myself then, right?
Yeah, definitely not. You know what I'm saying? I mean, definitely. You know, so like say if you made $30,000 last year in 5 short years, you have to be earning $50,000 just to have the same purchasing power that you have today.
Mm-hmm.
Now, about 20 years from now, you know.
Okay.
So the value of the dollar has been completely eroded, you know, during the last 3 decades, you know, and we know that for a fact, you know. you know, so, I mean, there's a lot of things going on right now.
Okay.
And so we're in this program in which that deals with getting – group purchasing gold and silver.
Okay.
And 60% off.
Okay.
So
well,
think about. Right. So 60% off of $50 is what?
Okay.
Of course, silver will be up soon to about $50. So
okay.
What? So you got 60% off. It'd be about $20. You'd be able to buy an ounce of silver. All right. Think about. $2,000 a piece of silver, gold now is about $2,000. Or will soon, you know what I'm saying, about $2,000, just an ounce. So 60% off would give you what? About $900. So we're looking at the ability in order to group purchase gold and silver. So not only will you have more of it in order to do the same things in which that these states are doing, then you'd be able to put it under any state or a trust and be able to do like the Rockefellers and the Rothschilds.
Okay.
Because that's how they have all their assets and property protected is in the trust.
Okay, I need to study more on that and get busy on that.
Right.
Yeah, I do. Because this thing is getting ready to fold.
Right.
Is this what you're talking about? with the Federal Reserve System getting ready to fold.
Right. Exactly. Exactly. So we have to be in position in order to do what we need to do, you know, as a group of people, individually, as a family. So for people who want to know more information, please give us a call at 252-257-3588. That's 252-257-3588. And there's another good program in which that is out there, too, in which that is called Zig Rewards, in which that we spoke about several times before on the show. And people really need to get into that. You know what I'm saying? My wife and I put in about $240. You know, I put in 20. She put in about 220.
Okay.
And we have now, you know, almost $30,000.
Okay.
In just 8 months.
Okay.
Ooh,
so that accumulated. That's how much people accumulated.
Right. Now you're making now you're making daily, 2% daily. You're making 2% daily on your money. Now that's something on which that is phenomenal, because even in the bank you only make 2% annually if you put your money in the bank. And I know Negroes love the bank. So you need to be putting in programs in which that, such as this, where you can actually make $50,000 in a year. Now that's residual income. You only thing you're doing is a 3 minute ad, 3 to 5 minute ad a day. That's it. But no, I know that's unbelievable, because you'd rather work 8 hours for an Albion for the European. I know. It's so hard to understand. Instead of 3 minutes for yourself, making $50,000 a year, you'd rather work 8 hours for $20,000 a year. Isn't that something? So for those who are really interested in prosperity, abundance, and you have gone beyond just the Crypto Dollar and T.D. Jakes mentality of prosperity teachings, and you really want some real money, you know what I'm saying? Of course, it's going to be virtual, but hell, when you have your money in the bank, it's virtual. You don't have it with you. So, I mean, these are ways in which that you have money. And how we know that it works, because my wife already got $5,000 already out of here. Already. And you still have $30,000 in there. So this is what people have to understand. You got to be able to make money work for you, not you work for money. So go to AileenLBay.ZeekRewards.com. Aileen, AileenLBay, dot Zeke, ZEEK, Rewards, RewardsCom. COM. AileenLBay.ZeekRewards.com. And check it out. All right? Call us if you need for us to walk you through the program. 252-257-3588. If you want residual income, you need residual income. If your family is breaking up, you know, wife and husband breaking up because of financial problems, we're giving you a chance in order to keep your family structure together, to be able to leave something for your children, be able to put your monies and your properties and your assets into a trust. We teach that also. So please give us a call. All right? Brother Ritland, you still there?
Yes, sir.
All right. You have any closing remarks, co-host?
Next time we talk, I'm not going to talk so much about the Moorish Science Temple next time. That's about the topics you're going to present. You know, because I think I spent a little bit too much time on talking about the temple and why they do things and stuff like that.
Well, I mean, the whole thing is about clarity.
Okay.
And I'm sure that those who listen, a lot of the people are into the Moorish information or have gone through it or have heard about it or have friends who's part of it. So they would like to have known those answers also.
Okay. Okay.
Mm-hmm. There's no problem with that.
Okay. Well, it was a pleasure talking to you, as always.
No doubt. Appreciate you being here with me tonight. And next week, y'all, we're going to have Wayne Chandler, author of Ancient Future. Next week's show is going to be called Return of the Ancient Future. I guarantee you don't want to miss this. All right, we out. Peace, y'all.
Peace and love.
We got a question. Let me get a question in right quick. 843, area code 843.
How you doing, Brother Owen?
Peace, brother.
Hey,
how
brother,
you?
How you doing?
All right.
I'm doing well.
All right. You almost
appreciate
missed
the guest also.
What's going on with you? You almost missed
what?
It.
All right, all is well. I wanted to ask two questions, even though I know you don't probably have time to answer.
Yes, we do.
You charge a fee for the trust, and that's number one. Number two is the Nation of Islam was the Morris Science Temple after Brother Jir Ali passed on. Some people say that he wasn't murdered. Some people say that he was.
All right. Well, let's put it this way. Allegedly, there's different stories. I'll tell you the different stories that is said about his death. Some say that he died because of a result of the police beating in which that he got when he went to jail, supposedly for the alleged murder of Green Bay, you know, Brother Green, who was the financier at the time, or the business manager at the time for the Moorish Holy Temple of Science / Moorish Science Temple of America. And according to reports, he went to jail for 2 weeks, Prophet Noble Jir Ali, and during that time period, he received beatings in which that caused him to catch pneumonia because it was cold in there, in which that supposedly he died, according to the death certificate, he died of pneumonia, bronchitis, tuberculosis. Now, that's three different illnesses, brother. Pneumonia, bronchitis, and tuberculosis. Now, this is for a brother who was healing people from pneumonia, bronchitis, and tuberculosis. So, to me, it's kind of fishy. To me. No, I wasn't there, but it just seemed fishy to me because he has healed people, according to many testimonies that I've read, he healed people from those particular diseases. Okay. Now, no, we teach you how to do the trust yourself. So we teach you how to do it. Okay?
Okay.
So if you
want
to give a donation, that is fine, but we teach you how to do it.
Okay. Well, either way is fine. I mean, your knowledge and your efforts in helping people, you know, is definitely worthy of, you know, some kind of fee, without a doubt.
And we have classes every Monday and Thursday in law. Every Monday and Thursday at 7:30 or either at 8 o'clock. Most of the time we do it at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And so what you have to do is email me, all right, at healingwingsonline@yahoo.com. That's healing wings, W-I-N-G-S, online, O-N-L-I-N-E, at yahoo.com. So healingwingsonline@yahoo.com. Email me there. And I email you the link for Monday and Thursdays. So tomorrow we have class, so you can come in tomorrow and begin teach you the science of trust. And we also have classes in which that if you want, they last 3 months. So you will learn much more than just the trust information. You will learn estate information, how to collapse the estate. You will learn the trust information. You will learn nationality. You will learn birthright. You will learn divine creed. You will learn indigenous affairs. You will learn international law. You will learn national law or supreme law of the land, such as the constitutions, the treaties, much, much more. All right?
All right.
And those classes are 3 months long for a contribution of
$500. Okay. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now going back to the part of my initial question in reference to the Nation of Islam. The Nation of Islam basically
According to the Moorish elders, David Ford L. and Honorable Elijah Muhammad were both members or steady attenders to the Moorish Holy Temple, Moorish Science Temple meetings. And allegedly, Masfar Muhammad was David Ford ill. This is what some reports state. According to my research, that's what is stated. And when Prophet Noble Dr. Ali was getting ready to go to jail, he put over Temple One in Chicago, David Ford Ill, who becomes later on Master Farah Muhammad, and takes over the Detroit Temple
Chapel
and name it Allah's Temple of Islam, in which that from Allah's Temple of Islam becomes the Nation of Islam later on.
Okay.
And then Honorable Elijah Muhammad, well, supposedly, if you go and do the research, his father, who was a UNIA member up under Marcus Garvey, as well as also we know that Noble Dr. Ali was also down with Marcus Garvey, because he refers to Marcus Garvey as the forerunner within the Holy Quran Circle 7 in the later chapters, as well as also the harbinger, which means the one who comes before, who came before him, just as John came before Jesus Christ.
Right.
So hence, in a sense, as me and Brother Rutland L. was talking about, he symbolized an appearance or a coming of Jesus Christ.
Right.
You know. But we all do once we reach our higher selves. And
that's why I understand it. Yes.
And that's through the realization of Allah and man. Once you come back in contact with your higher self, then you become the Christ or Melchizedek.
Exactly.
You know. So you become up under these different associations because they're all references to the ancient comedic teachings of Heru. Heru was Malkus Utek. Heru was Keres. All right, Heru was God, or the Netter, or the force of nature, which is the soul. The soul is talking about the awakened soul. The awakened soul is your higher self. When the soul is asleep and has not the Kundalini connection, or said has not gone to awaken or saw from his slumber and resurrected him from his sleep, and now resurrect him from his night to a 90-degree perpendicular level, then he is not worthy yet to be said that he has conquered his lower self.
Uh-huh.
He is still ran by his lower self, and he would do the deeds of the lower self, lust, greed, envy, jealousy, and hatred, and everything that harms. But the higher self is the love, mercy, justice, and right. So when he is awakened, the soul is awakened through the touch of the Mother Goddess principle within you, which is Shekinah, or the Holy Spirit, or Aset, which is Isis, the Kundalini, then he is able to be the higher self and have now conquered the lower self, and Set no longer has any battle with Heru. Heru now shines within his kingdom.
Exactly.
As the sun shines upon planet Earth. All right, so these are the sciences.
Wow, okay. Yeah, I heard something in reference to that, the brother that you was calling John the Baptist, Marcus Garvey.
Right.
He said he was, I forgot his title, but something in reference to peace.
Yeah, Mosaic.
You know.
Emotion.
And when he was going through those issues, yeah, Brother Noble Dr. Ali tried to help him, and he refused to help.
Right. Matter of fact, when Marcus Garvey went to jail in Atlanta, Georgia, Prophet Noble Dr. Ali went down to see him, and there's a postcard and writings of him actually going within the newspaper of the Moorish Guide at the time, in which that spoke about him going down into the deep south in order to see Sir Marcus Garvey, or Mosiah Garvey, the Messiah. All right? So, and he spoke about on a postcard back to his wife, Pearl Drew Ali, that everything was going good and that he got a chance to see Marcus Garvey and that they spoke and that he was very pleased of the progress in which that prophet of Drew Ali was making.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Right.
They did all know each other, just like people say, oh, well, Aleem and him and they never know each other. They lie.
Right, indeed.
Right. You see, when there's a lot of conscious people around during the same time period, sometimes you get a chance to meet them.
Right.
Oh, yeah, traveling in the circles, right, Noble?
Right. No, because there's so very few of us. There's no way that you just bypass a conscious brother who's doing good things. It's almost impossible.
It is.
Yes, indeed. As long as you're on that frequency, or even if you're in the know and not exactly on the right frequency, you know who's who.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
Yeah. I once seen a picture. It was in front of one of the temples. Father Divine, all of them was in this picture.
Mm-hmm. Right. Right. Jones, Father Divine, Daddy Grace. Right. Those were the pictures closer towards 1916 when they had the Moabite Holy Temple of Science of the world there in Newark, New Jersey, in which that was formed in 1916 after, I guess, the restructuring of the Canaanite Temple. And then that was right before he moved to Chicago.
Okay.
Yeah, so that was before all of them branched out from out of that temple in Newark, New Jersey, to go and become Daddy Grace, Father Divine, Prophet Jones, and others.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Right, they all came from out of that particular temple in Newark, New Jersey, in which that used to be the Canaanite temple, in which that he reformatted in 1916 to a Moabite holy temple of science of the world, in which that also became known as the Moorish Divine National Movement during that same time period.
I see.
Mm-hmm. And also the Moorish Holy Temple of the world, too. So all of that came around during that same time period, unofficially in 1916.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, 1926.
Right. Was the formation of the Moorish Temple of Science, or the Moorish Holy Temple of Science. The reason why holy can't be utilized is because it was a civic organization at that particular time period. They didn't have a religious affiliation in Chicago or in Cook County at the time. That didn't happen until 2 years later, in which that became the Moorish Temple of Science of America, the Moorish Science Temple of America in 1928. But prior to that, holy couldn't be used, so it was just the Moorish Temple of Science instead of the Moorish Holy Temple of Science. But officially, it was still the Moorish Holy Temple of Science. It never changed. But on paperwork, it was called the Moorish Temple of Science.
Okay. And was it 1934, Farad, or?
Well, 1934 was when Charles Kirkman Bay became the Moorish Science Temple of America Incorporated. And basically, the Moorish Science Temple of America, all of that was basically at a standstill because the only person who, there was only one temple in which that was still utilized at that time, and that was in Chicago, which is Temple Number 1, and that was up under E. Milly Hill, Supreme Grand Sheikh E. Milly Hill. And what happened was is that they put out the rumor that he supposedly died in the insane asylum. And so, but that's not true, according to reports.
Yeah, that's what I heard.
Right, according to reports of Emilio's wife, she said that he died on an airplane coming back from a business trip. Okay, so there's different things in which that is said. We don't know the truth because we weren't there, but we have to still take into account what each one is saying so that we can come to some type of consensus, objects ever arise or come up. So the temple was supposedly was left within the hands of his wife, and some say that it was turned over to another brother in which that he was working with. Some say it wasn't. And, you know, so that's where the problem comes in at, is based on that. With Charles Kirkman Bay, he had a, he did have a lineage in which that he did, was able to make other Supreme Grand Sheiks in his state. All right, or who was actually known as the Supreme Grand Moderator and Advisor. They never really took that name, Supreme Grand Sheik, until the 1980s, all right? And that was actually through National Grand Sheik Moderator and Advisor Robert Lavelle, okay? Now, during the same time period, you had in 1934 the beginning of the Moorish Holy Temple of Science, in which that they were still carrying the name Moorish Holy Temple of Science. And the reason why they stopped carrying the name Moorish Holy Temple of Science was because John Given Ill, who stated he was the reincarnated prophet, started utilizing the Moorish Holy Temple of Science. So the Moorish Holy Temple of Science of the world was still going on, in which that they were still using that name. The Dingle brothers were still utilizing it, and the Moorish Science Temple of America, too. Okay? And then you had a brother who was utilizing the Moorish Holy Temple of Science again, and that was Brother Anderson L., all right? Grand Sheik Anderson L., from out of the Virginia area. And he said when he joined the temple in 1928 that before the change to the Moorish Science Temple of America, it was called the Moorish Holy Temple of Science of the World. And that Prophet Noble Jali put a sticker over top of the Moorish Holy Temple of Science of the World and wrote Moorish Science Temple of America. And he said that most of the charters was like that except for two, which that came from out of West Virginia and Newark, New Jersey. So, in that sense, the Moorish Holy Temple of Science, or the Moorish Holy Temple of Science of the world, was still able to go forward, because any subordinate temples under those particular temples would still have the same name as what? Moorish Holy Temple of Science. So, this is how it was carried on. And so, people doing a lot of fussing about nothing, and they haven't done the research properly. So, they get confused, and they get upset, and they get frustrated, and when the only thing they have to do is go back and do the research.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, exactly. That was what I was going to lean towards after I asked you again. The date that they started the Nation of Islam, you know,
right?
Asiatic,
of course, that was the
around
same year.
The same.
Right, 1934,
right.
Exactly. That's when John Given Ill started his group, which was Moorish Holy Temple of Science / the Moorish Science Temple of America. That's when the Moorish Science Temple of America incorporated by Charles Kirkman Bay, and that's when the Nation of Islam officially got started with the disappearance of Master Farah Muhammad / David Ford L., who went back to Oakland, California.
Excuse me. I thought he went back to Arabia somewhere.
No, he went to Oakland, California, where he was a cook in a restaurant.
Gotta get that fee out.
Because I had a brother who actually worked with him in the restaurant. Brother Bilal, who lives in Fayetteville, North Carolina, right now.
So he wasn't the guy that came in person.
Right, and we interviewed him about 6 years ago. And we had him on tape saying this. We got him on tape saying this. That he worked with Master Farah Muhammad. That he knew Master Farah Muhammad personally. So when I showed him a picture of Master Farah Muhammad, what do you think he did? He identified him as the same as the Moorish elders did and said that was him in the upper left-hand corner in the Moor Science Temple of 1928.
Okay.
As well as also he verified that Elijah Muhammad, when he took out that, talking about $100,000 to prove that that was the Master Farah Muhammad. He said that was the same Master Farah Muhammad. That was the same man.
But see, still most Muslims in the Nation of Islam believe that he was God in person.
Of course. And all of you are gods, according to John 10:34 and Psalms 82:2-6. All of you are gods. So you're not only God in personage. You are God in personage too. Allah is in man. Allah is
okay.
in your... That's all that means.
Okay.
When we're in our higher self, right, brother?
When we're in our higher self. When we're in our lower self, then you're not in cahoots with God. You're in cahoots with something other than God. Even though it's still God, it's something other. It's not God in his highest sense. It's God in his lowest sense.
Okay.
His lowest mind or in his lower self or lower nature.
See, the understanding that when I first entered the Nation in 92, and most Muslims at that time believed that he was the God.
Right, of course.
The God, you know.
Right.
In person, you know.
Yeah.
And but the way you explain it to me now, I have a far more better understanding.
Right.
Than I did before.
Mm-hmm.
Like, wow.
Well, that's because you have to combine the lessons being taught in both schools in theology, such as with also within the Nation of Gods and Earths, or the Five Percenters. All of us have pieces of the puzzle in which that we extended from out of each other because we are all Asiatics. That's one thing that we can all agree upon. That's what a brother was trying to get at me. Well, why are you using the 5% flag? Well, because within the 5% flag, the Moorish Science Temple flag is there, as well as also the Nation of Islam flag, in which that symbolizes unification between all of us.
Mm-hmm.
You know, brother, you ain't supposed to be using that. Brother, I was a 5%er at the age of 14. I'm 43 now, so that means almost 30 years ago. Are you even past 30? So that means that I've been studying your lessons before you was born.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I'm not going to come, you know what I'm saying, with the same mentality that I had when I was 14. Yo, please, God, yeah, you know, what's today's mathematics? You know, what's the science for today? You know what I'm saying? I'm not coming with you like that because I'm damn 30 years more older now.
Older and wiser, right?
Exactly.
Right.
But it's still my foundation, so I know
exactly.
When I got enough sense to see the similarities between the teachings to know that if you want to say black, then that's fine, but what if I say Asiatic? Oh, I don't have a problem with that. I know you don't. Neither do you, Nation of Islam. No, I don't have a problem with that either. Oh, well, neither do you, Moors, do you? No, ain't got a problem with that. Okay, well, we all Asiatic. Can we go with that? Yeah. Well, that seemed like that's the word in which that would unify us then.
Right.
We can pick and debate over Moor and black all day long. But when I say Asiatic, all of you niggas stand to attention.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
Indeed. Even if it's your spirit that pulls you up.
Exactly. Exactly.
Lord, that's another thing that I wanted to bring on. If we could, the brothers in the know could basically contact each other and say, everybody can put two laws or two rules in this rule book so that everybody can come together the right way.
Mm-hmm.
In regards to how they're numbered, they're in the book. That way, when brothers do come together and meet, it makes it easier for people to leave those egos and pride outside, you know, on a hanger or a coat rack, no matter how big the coat rack has to be.
Exactly.
So anytime anybody gets in violation and gets into emotion, somebody could just scream out, you know, you're in violation of rule number one. You know, a 12 or 1600, whatever,
mm-hmm.
to bring the peace so that the dialogue can go on and, you know, it can really bring about change. Because I was talking to a sister today, and she was talking about, what did those, what do they call themselves? The something five, Thomas Jefferson, Ben Franklin, what did they write, 1776?
Oh, yeah, the Declaration of Independence.
Yes.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly. You know, these are the same things that we can utilize to, you know, initiate into sovereignty, you know, to prove or whatever, because, you know, I'm sure one of us was there, one of our ancestors was there at that time.
Right.
You know, so basically this paperwork is ours, even though it didn't have anything to do with us at that time, because we were sovereign.
Right.
And
well,
now that basically...
Right. We wrote those constitutions for them.
Yeah.
Exactly. Those were possessions of each other. So you had the Articles of Association, the Articles of Confederation, the Declaration of Independence, then the Constitution for the United States of America and its Bill of Rights, which are the first 10 amendments. So, you know, that is basically, you know what I'm saying, the science right there, you know. That is really the science, you know, and we can use it because we wrote those particular constitutions for them. You know, we had our own constitution on which that was based on the Iroquois Confederation and the Algonquin information. You know,
exactly.
So when we go back and study the Iroquois and the Algonquin, we'll start to see how we work with each other in certain sorts and fashions as indigenous people. You had the Treaty of Peace before the Peace Treaty of Morocco and the United States. We had our own Treaty of Peace amongst the five civilized tribes and the 12 Shoshone tribes and others, on which that we came together as the Iroquois Confederation or Chickasaw Confederation, which is Cherokee.
Right, right.
That,
right.
You know, we combined
right.
The Seneca, the Cherokee, Cree, you know, which is the Muscogee and the Seminole, you know, later on. All of these became part of that same thing. But there's a lot of information. Go back and read Camp Holmes Treaty, H-O-L-M-E-S, Camp Holmes Treaty. You know, you'll see a whole lot of tribes mentioned in there. Matter of fact, you'll see the Wichita, Washita tribes mentioned in there, Washita Nations. And they speak of the Cherokee, the Choctaw, the Cherokee, the Creek, which is the Muscogee and the Seneca and the Comanche and all of us being part of the Washita nations or the Wichita nations.
Right, exactly, exactly. Yeah, no, brother, I brought that up because of, it's like time is marching on and in some
right.
aspects it's been accelerated and being that there's so many facets of us that are honoring our ancestors and claiming our birthright nationality in some shape or form.
Mm-hmm.
But for some reason, you know, we can't exactly sit down and break bread because instead of us building,
right?
You
well,
know,
that's what we're doing right now.
We listen intently to each other to find a reason to, you know, get up and walk away.
Well, that's what we're doing right now. We're putting together a Moorish government, in which I can send you the information. When you email me, I can send you out the information and the layout of everything that we put together. And this is something actually from 1997. That we're still working on and perfecting. So you'll see everything in which that is going on and how everything is being structured, and you'll see how all of us all coming together. Myself, Brother Hakeem Bey, Brother Taj Tariq Bey, you know, and many others, how we are all coming together. You know, so there's no separation amongst us because we always knew the plan was to uplift fallen humanity. It's some of the so-called new Moors who are coming in claiming their eyes are open, but yet their ears are closed. You know,
yes,
so,
exactly, exactly.
You know, that are causing the troubles and the problems between the
yes.
and having the various fractions. You know, is because they're coming in with ego, with their lower selves. You know, and so really their eye isn't open, if you get what I mean. Okay.
Indeed, indeed. And that's why I emphasize on rules to, you know, to govern these events and whatnot, you know, because everybody does have, you know, a piece of the puzzle, you know, a piece of Osiris's body. But overall, you know, because of going emotion, they don't feel that they need to put that piece down because of, you
that's
know,
right.
and that brings separation because anytime somebody go out in the street, I don't care if they go to the store and they're talking about something that they disagree with, there's brothers out there that hear what this person is saying. And if they gravitate toward this individual more than the other, or the older brothers, you know, 35, 40 or whatever, you know, it's still complication there. So there's probable cause to disagree.
Right.
You know, disagreeable Moors, you know.
Right, right, no doubt about
that's
it.
That's my point. But I'm definitely going to email you.
Okay. All right. We have another caller, two online. Caller, you've been bought in. My name is Eric Cole, 111. That means, I guess, it's a private call or however, but you can come on in. You've been hooked on up, so come on and give a talk. You got a question or something?
Islam, peace. This is Brother Messiah.
Greetings, Brother Messiah.
Greetings, brother.
Yeah, I ain't got no question. I just wanted to add on to
on, brother. That's what we hear about.
That's peace. I just wanted to add on about Master Farouk Muhammad and the Nation of Islam and how they view him as being God, and science that the Father Allah brought to the youth, showing and proving to the youth that the lessons through the degrees that you're studying, the original man is Allah, right?
Right.
Now, I used to go to the Nation of Islam temples all the time. My foundational structure of study is the Nation of Gods and Earths. Now, you got an elite member or an elite group amongst the Nation of Islam, or the hierarchy of the Nation of Islam, which will have and obtain these sciences of those lessons and won't teach it to general members or people that come there, i.e. citizens. And they know and understand who Fard was. They know and understand who the original man is, understand who God is. But they're not just going to get that information to anybody that comes in there. They conceal it. They'll make you work your way up in the. And I've even been to more science temples that act in the same manner. You know, right now, like I was building with you earlier, I go to temple number 10, which is headed by Grand Sheik Nature El Bey. And that temple is to say, it's an order of all the ones I've been in. You know, and you know, we've been doing some things. I'm trying to bring active movement to the temple, and not just, you know, not just be a passive member coming there to feel good about hearing, you know, science is being advocated, not to just come there and hear the Holy Quran or the Moore Science Temple being broke down, the one-on-ones being broke down. I'm trying to put this thing in order. I'm trying to make this stuff a movement, in other words. You know, I just wanted to add on to that, you know, and also to Farouk Muhammad as far as the Nation of Islam and how they view him as being God Allah. But, you know, like I said, a lot of members of the Nation of Islam who don't even really understand what the teachings are, just like you got a lot of members of the Nation of Gods and Earths who don't really understand the 120 lessons, just like you got a lot of members of the Moore Science Temple of America who don't really understand the lessons within the Moore Science Temple.
Exactly. Exactly.
And, you know, I don't really blame the members. I blame the people who are teaching it. Because, they, like you said earlier, you know, they got this ego, and, you know, kind of, they are the 10% when you take it back to the lessons of the Nation of Islam. They acting in that manner. When they try to get information, certain pieces of knowledge for themselves, not, you know, advocated to the general members of whatever the civic organization may be. No, I just wanted to add on that.
Yeah, just like what they do to the Masons, right? You know, you proceed to each level, and you can take that test and pass it, but, you know, they don't make sure that you understand what you just, you know.
Exactly. That's another thing. Like, I come across Masons all the time, so-called black Masons. You know, I just building about general stuff that they should know within the teachings of Masonry.
But they don't know.
You know, just like a strategy.
You'd be surprised, especially in Prince Hall Masonry, a lot of them that don't know they're on Masonry.
Exactly.
They really don't know. I have problems with them too. I've studied a lot of the esoteric part of Masonry, and it annoys a lot of them. And they're so steeped in ritual all the time that they don't understand the rituals that what they are doing, the esoteric or the occult meaning of the rituals of what they are doing. They really don't.
A lot of them just, you know, they get involved just so that they can receive all the benefits of brotherhood, but don't really get into the esoteric science of what degrees actually mean.
No.
You know, the full background or the full foundational structure of what the organization is for.
Right. Right. Where it came from, the lot of material come from England. You know, which is a lie.
I could dig back further than that, just from the history of I've studied, you know, in regards to H. Templar. And the Templars sacking.
No, well, all you got to do is get the clocks of destiny in and just have it under your arm and just sit at a bus stop somewhere, a library, and have that book.
You better believe it, brother.
The stars and Masons walk up to you.
Clock of destiny
1 and 2, yes. Oh, my God, them was two very powerful books. And that's another thing. I come across Moors, and they'll be like, yeah, I don't deal with C.M. Bay's Clock of Destiny.
True.
I'd be like,
I get that too.
It's not Skim Bay's Clock of Destiny. The Clock of Destiny. He's just the preparer of the Clock of Destiny that we know and understand today. The Clock of Destiny is ancient principles. You'll find that all over the globe. It's not Skim Bay's. See, people would get caught up in preparers of certain documents.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, you know, somebody might reject Noble Drew Ali in the Circle 7 Quran. Or the Holy Quran of the Moor Science Temple. Trying to say that it's Noble Drew Ali's Holy Quran of the Moor Science Temple, when he's just the preparer of it. Those sciences that are in that are before him, before he was made manifest in the flesh.
Mm-hmm. That's true. You know, a lot of them, when I deal with C.M. Bay, the Moors won't, Masons won't either. But this is the true knowledge.
It's amazing that they won't deal with it, but yet he's a third degree Mason, Master Mason. Third, and plus he say that he's a 360, you know what I'm saying, Master Astrologer. Hence the reason why he called it the Clock of Destiny, because it was based on astrology, which was the mastering of those 12 cycles of time. You know, so, I mean, the zodiac sign. So that's what he was really... like, that's what the brother was talking about. Brother Messiah is talking about those are the principles. Those are the principles in which that deals with the star configurations, constellations, zodiac signs. How
exactly.
You want to say that you don't study that when farmers know that at your crops until it's the right season? You know,
exactly.
When women know that their menstrual cycles is controlled by the moon because of the water tides, because of the influence that the moon has upon the waters of life, hence of even of the menses. Every 28 days or so, the moon changes phases, particular phases, and the woman's cycle comes on based on those particular phase changes. You know, so what you're talking about, that nature don't have an influence on you. The sun is the giver of life. You don't have enough vitamin D. You develop what's called SAD, or seasonal affliction disorder. And these particular... bodies or astral bodies or cholesterol or celestial bodies don't have an influence on you? How silly do you sound?
Pretty silly, Moore.
Yeah, they silly. And this is why when they say something like that, you already know what level they're on. They're in their lower nature. They don't have a higher integrated thought. They don't have a holistic mind. So you're
exactly.
Right. I mean, I have to leave you where you are, brother. You in the ditch already, and I can't follow you there. Ain't no blind man. I got an eye. My eye can see. That's when my shit is all eye seeing.
There you go.
But I'm sure you do say, this is a rope, and you tie a knot on the end of the rope and throw one side of the rope into the ditch and keep moving.
Right.
So if he's ready to walk out in the sun again, you know, this is truly the way. You know, I interjected so I could say now, what do you think about the clocks, the Torah and the Kabbalah?
The Torah is nothing more than the five first books of the Old Testament, you know, which is called the Pentateuch or the Tanakh, you know what I'm saying? So when we're talking about, you know, the Torah, I mean, that's the first five books of the Bible. Any Christian, Muslim, or Jew have to recognize those particular books because those are the books. The Kabbalah.
Right. Yeah, I didn't mean to say Torah. I meant to say the Tree of Life and
okay.
The Kabbalah. That's what I meant to say.
Right. Well, the Kabbalah, the Tree of Life, comes, you know, the Tree of Life information is where the Kabbalah extends from. It's from actually a design in which that they actually found on the walls of ancient Egypt and in Samaria.
Mm-hmm.
They always had the Tree of Life. And that Tree of Life symbolized components of your physical body. For example, your spinal column and the extension of the nerves coming from out the spinal column and forming particular organs and glands in your body. You know, so those particular branches or, you know, nerves act as communication wires or lines, just like it do for, you know, you trying to hook up a computer or a TV, you know, or a laptop, you know, is a wire in which that connects those particular things so that electricity, which is or message codes, can be passed through. So it's the same thing with the Tree of Life, and which is your physical body itself. That is the Tree of Life or the Tree of Knowledge and Good and Evil. You know, when you take it to the lower self, it's the knowledge of good and evil. When you take it to your higher self, it's the Tree of Life.
Right. Yeah. I was bringing that in reference to the clocks, you know, because it's to me, I feel it's basically synonymous. I mean, look at certain levels of that tree or the Kabbalah, and then look at like an astrological sign and see some of the similarities.
Right.
You know, and personality trait or whatever. Or
right.
It's governing energies.
Right, exactly. And that's the whole point. Your organs are all connected to the seven major planets, so your major seven chakras are connected to each of those two. Elijah Muhammad said that there's life on seven planets, but he was talking about your seven chakras, or what is called conscious centers or your melanin centers. And there's life within each of those.
First World Order Radio, finally, we are on the air, no doubt. All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio, every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intentions straight out.
All right. So, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories. Shit,